Calling All Cars, the copyrighted program created by Rio Grande.
Los Angeles Police calling all cars. Attention all cars, broadcast 250 at Wilshire and Western. Assist the officer. That's all. The road is smooth.
Supposing a friend of yours were crossing the street, and you could see that his next step would plunge him into an open manhole with possibly serious injury. As a friend, you'd call out to warn him of his danger, wouldn't you? Well, friends, in that same spirit, I'm calling out to those of you who are flirting with another kind of misfortune, probably without knowing it. Don't court the financial disaster of motor failure or premature breakdown by trying to get by with flabby, short-lived oil. Just think of all the friction-resisting, heat-defying Realube you could have bought with that last repair bill. Just try to break Realube down with your highest speed. Even with the help of a sometimes hot-tempered weatherman, it can't be done. Here's how you can prove it to yourself. The next time you drive into the red and white Rio Grande station in your neighborhood for a tank full of police car performance Rio Grande cracked, take aboard a crankcase full of Realube. Drive 1,000 miles. Then look at your oil gauge. Then feel the still great film strength and body of this best lubricant. And I can hear you saying...
That was the straight dope Dr. Lindsley gave us the other night. This Realube is the newest and finest motor oil sold in the West.
The story of the Artful Dodger is to be found in the confidential files of the Los Angeles Police Department. We have therefore requested Chief of Police James E. Davis to open our program. Chief Davis.
One of the most elusive criminals that my department has ever had to deal with is the story of the man we are to hear tonight. He was one of the hardest men to capture and convict that we have dealt with. He had a criminal record that began in 1911, and yet he had never been held in prison longer than 2 years. In spite of the fact that he had received sentences of 15 years, 7 years, and in one case a sentence of 1 year to life. He was apparently an intelligent man who should have known better. But he had convinced himself that he could lead a life of crime and make it pay. How he was dissuaded from this idea will be revealed as our program progresses. I shall have further facts to give you at the end of the show.
On a bleak day in December, Captain Chitwood of the narcotic detail sat talking to a newspaper reporter.
Pity the poor peddlers on a day like this?
I don't pity the peddler on any day, but I would like to put my hand on the guy who's supplying this dope.
Mister, I wouldn't go out after the guy who makes all the narcotics in Los Angeles in a rain like this.
Now, what's this story you had to tell me?
Well, this guy, Courtney, has got a fake automobile insurance racket that he's operating out here at Western and Wilshire. But I've got a hunch that that so-called business is only a blind.
What makes you think so?
Well, the grand jury's investigating him, and there hasn't been an entry in his ledger in 2 years.
What else have you found out about him?
This bird was picked up in 28 on a fugitive warrant from Chicago. But for some screwy reason, Chicago turned him loose.
Wait a minute, I want to get his record. Will you go down to the record division and get the file on Don Courtney right away, please? You haven't told me why you think this fellow's peddling dope.
Well, in the first place, his brother Ed is a known addict.
Well, I'm beginning to connect this up now. This Ed Courtney is a brother of a guy they call Dapper Don, isn't he?
That's the one.
Yeah. We've had Ed in here several times, but we've never been able to prove anything on him.
Well, I think this is the time you're going to do it. He runs around with a fellow who's a chauffeur for one of our glamour girls out at Paramount. And while she's inside running the gamut of her emotions from A to B, the chauffeur is outside using her car to peddle dope.
Does our friend Courtney work with him?
All the time. Courtney and the chauffeur live together in the same apartment.
Well, where do you and your paper come into this picture?
Well, I think this guy Courtney is pulling a lot of rackets around here, and there's something screwy about the way he gets away with it. We're willing to stand part of the expense, if...
If what?
If you'll promise to give me an exclusive on the story.
Carter, have you gone crazy?
Sure, I ought to let you catch your crooks yourself.
Yeah, well, it has been done, you know.
Yeah, sure. But don't try to kid me, Eddie. You know, and I know, that you haven't gone after this fellow because you haven't the money to build up the case. Don't forget, I read the budget recommendations, too.
Oh, all right, all right. How do you want to work it?
My people will put up enough money to rent an office next door to Courtney's. There's a vacant office in the building that joins the one that Courtney has his in. We can plant a dictaphone in there, and maybe we can get a line on them.
Here's Courtney's record, Captain.
Oh, thanks, Paul. You know Charlie Carter, don't you?
Yeah, but we call him Nick.
That ought to be a good name for him. He's going to play detective for a while.
Oh, that's so? What's up?
We're going to try to get the goods on Don Courtney.
Yeah, it's a good trick if you can do it.
Hey, this guy's got enough aliases to start a jail of his own.
Right.
He's been picked up as Regan, Osborne, Battier, and as Charlie Struce.
And on everything from grand larceny to extortion.
To say nothing of robbery, escape, and bond jumping.
And you can add contributing to the delinquency of a minor in grand theft bunco.
Mm-hmm. Otherwise, he's a model citizen, I suppose.
Oh, yes. Complete with spats, carnation, and cane.
So that's where he gets the Dapper Don stuff, huh?
That's right.
Carter, I don't think you've told me everything. Just why is your scandal sheet so interested in this gentleman?
Well, Eddie, I will tell you. Did you ever hear of the Bilkins Investment Corporation?
Nope. That's a suggestive name, though.
You've no idea. Ever hear of the Minority Stockholders Committee or the Lincoln Realty Landowners Committee?
The answer's still no.
Did you ever hear of the Cincinnati Realty Corporation?
Well, certainly. Perfectly legitimate firm of subdividers.
Yeah, that's right. So legitimate, in fact, that our friend Dapper Don was able to cause them so much trouble that they had to get an injunction from Judge Dorn to keep him quiet.
How come?
Well, it seems our Dapper friend was carrying on a whispering campaign.
Is that so? What was he whispering about?
Well, it turns out that the Cincinnati people were developing a new tract, and our friend Courtney wanted to get his hands on it, so he formed a Cincinnati Realty Corporation Lot Owners Recovery Commission.
Mm. Sounds important.
It was important to the Cincinnati people.
Just what was Mr. Courtney going to do for the lot owners?
Well, he convinced some of the owners that they'd made bad investments when they bought lots. He told them that he had a lot of money invested in the tract and that he was representing the minority lot owners, and he could help them get their money back.
For a consideration, no doubt.
Naturally. His minimum fee was 10% of the original investment.
My gosh, that's high.
Nothing cheap about Dapper Don. Of course, when the Saps found out that their investment was perfectly safe and with a legitimate company, it was too late. Dapper Don had their 10% and they had nothing.
What was the big idea behind all this?
There's somebody back of him with money who wanted that tract to land. And they figured the simplest way to get it was to run the owning company into bankruptcy.
Oh. Well, that's been done before.
Yes, and it's being done again on a building and loan out in Hollywood.
Well, why doesn't somebody tell the grand jury about these things?
My friend, your lack of sophistication amazes me. Not only has the grand jury been told, but so has the Corporation Commission. And Dapper Don goes merrily along, still whispering.
Yeah, so you want me to go out and pick him up on a narcotics charge, huh?
I don't care what you pick him up on, so long as I get the first interview with him.
Okay, Tom Swift, get your wireless machine. Let's go.
Office right over there, across the air shaft. The one with the Venetian blinds in it.
Doesn't look like a very big layout.
That one and the one adjoining it.
We're going to have to put dictaphones in both of them.
What's the matter with tapping the telephone?
It's illegal.
So what?
So we're not going to do it.
No, sir, you're going to do it the hard way.
That's right.
You're getting like Horatio Alger.
Yeah.
Hey, it looks like somebody's sitting on Courtney's desk.
Yeah, that's where the delinquency of the minor comes in.
Mm. Hey, what time does this guy go home?
Well, about 10 minutes, if he's on schedule.
You know all the answers, don't you?
I've been working on this case.
Does the blonde go with him?
Yeah, usually.
Nuts.
You're going to have to be what is known as agile to get over there.
No trick at all. I've done it lots of times.
You're going to get shot climbing in windows someday.
What does that guy do here this late at night?
I'm surprised at you.
He makes telephone calls. What do you think?
Oh, yeah, I know. Two minority stockholders.
There they go.
If he runs true to form, he'll leave a light on.
Well, that'll help.
He's getting thrifty. He turned it off.
Any chance of his coming back?
Never has before.
How about night watchman here?
A couple of door rattlers will make the rounds about once an hour.
All right, let's get over there. Powell, you go get the car and bring it around the back door, and one of us will let you in.
Okay, Eddie.
Okay, newshound, let's go.
Better watch those telephone wires. I tripped over them the last time I came across here.
Hey, you're a regular housebreaker, aren't you?
No, just a private investigator.
Yeah, I know. Nick Carter, the boy detective. If we can just get this window up, we're set. There.
See? There's nothing to it.
Hmm. Not a very impressive setup.
Serves his purpose.
What does he call this joint?
The Metropolitan Automobile Association.
How about all these other companies he's supposed to represent?
Just stick around. You'll find out about them.
It's Hey, have you talked to the Bunko squad about this?
No, we can do that later. They might not want to string along with the paper.
Well, we better go down and let Powell in.
Come on, there's a rear entrance fire escape down here.
Doesn't seem to be many offices occupied here.
Well, they're not. Just a couple more besides Courtney's.
Hey, Harry, bring your stuff up this way.
Okay, but don't make so much noise. I just saw a couple of these merchants' cops down the street.
Hope they keep out of sight until we get these dictaphones installed.
Yeah, if they come snooping around, we can tell them we're working for the telephone company. Here, give me a hand with this.
Why didn't you bring the rest of the communications division? There's enough wire here to wire the whole building.
Well, you never can tell what you need.
Where'd you leave the car?
A couple of doors down the alley.
Better close that door.
Where are we going to put those microphones?
Under the desk, back of the middle drawer. We'll run the wire under the carpet.
We can run the wire right along the telephone line here and we'll be out of sight.
Well, there's only one drawback to these dictaphone setups. You can't hear the other end of telephone conversations.
And believe me, boy, from what I hear about our friend Courtney, some of those conversations should be worth listening to. What are you looking for?
Dope, of course.
I doubt if you'll find it around here. Hanky's brother keeps all the supply.
We'll darn soon find out. How about it, Harry? You about through?
Yeah, just about.
What the devil's that?
Oh, I knocked over this cockeyed chair.
Now, you'll have every door rattler in town up here in a minute.
Here, Carter, throw this roll of wire across the air shaft.
Come on, let's get out of here. Quiet. I hear someone coming. Probably our merchant police.
Yeah, there's a time when night watchmen can be very inconvenient.
Who's up there?
Nobody, boss, just us chickens.
Quiet, you fool.
Cross your fingers, maybe you'll go away.
Do you hear me? Who's up there?
Got a hammer, Harry?
Yeah.
Drop it real hard.
Looks like our friend is completely discouraged.
He probably got a look at us three thugs. Come on, let's get out of here while we got a chance. Hey, what time does Courtney get here in the morning?
About 9:30.
We'll be in our office next door waiting for him.
Early next morning, the officers arranged for Powell to attempt a buy from Ed Courtney. Chitwood and Carter were listening on receivers in the office the newspaper man had rented. As the hours went by, they heard numerous telephone conversations, mostly of the same pattern.
Drexel 0456, Minority Stockholders Committee. Oh, yes, I'm quite familiar with that company.
I'll say he is.
Well, I'll tell you, old man, I'm afraid you've lost your money. No, I wouldn't want to take to get it back for you. Well, let's see. I'll tell you what to do. You mail us your check for $49.95, and we'll look into it for you. Yes. Well, that's to cover the registration and title search. Hmm. Yes, that's right. Why, absolutely. We'll get every penny of it back.
Way back?
Yes. Suppose you get in touch with me in about a week. Mm-hmm. That's right. Goodbye.
So that's the way it works.
That's just part of it. Stick around.
Bilkins Investment Corporation, Courtney speaking. Yes? Oh, yes, I know that company quite well. Of course, I wouldn't want you to quote me on this, but my investigators tell me they're due to go on the rocks any day now.
Would you get that?
Yeah. I wouldn't be surprised to pick up the morning paper and see where they've filed bankruptcy proceedings. Mm-hmm. Well, of course, I couldn't make you any definite promises, but we do represent the minority stockholders, and we're making every effort to get our money back. I see. Well, how much stock have you? Oh, $10,000.
Oh.
Well, of course, you know we charge a slight fee for our services. Yes, about 10%. Huh? Well, of course, if you feel that's a little high, you might stop and consider your chances of getting your money at all. Yeah. Well, that's fine. I thought you'd see it our way. Oh, yes, we require a small deposit in advance, about 5%. Mm-hmm. That's fine. Yeah. Well, we'll send a messenger right over for your check. Goodbye.
Say, this guy's doing a land office business.
You ain't heard nothing yet. From the stories I've been hearing, this guy loses his temper and throws the furniture around if he doesn't clean up $5,000 a day.
Five? Oh, go on. There aren't that many suckers.
Hold it. Here it comes.
Lincoln Realty Landowners Committee, Mr. Jones speaking. Oh, it's you. What do you want? Now, listen, I told you yesterday when you came down to the office to keep out of here. And I told you to keep away from Ed and not be telling him things. You get to talking to him, and the first time he's all hopped up, he'll spill his insides all over the place.
Oh, so Ed takes dope, huh?
Sure, he's a hophead.
Oh, but you can't trust him, I tell you. Oh, now listen, honey, don't be that way. You're just a kid, you know. I don't want you to start running around with guys like Ed. He's not the right kind for you.
A lot of brotherly love there.
He cut his own mother's throat for a dime.
Yeah, honey, I know, but you're only 18. Well, sure, I'm going to marry you. Didn't I tell you I would?
Is that the delinquency you were talking about?
Oh, that's it.
Well, I'm glad it's out of my department.
Oh, listen, baby. I'm throwing a party at the hotel tonight. How about getting a couple of your friends and meeting me there, huh? Who? Why, she's only 16. But you... Well, all right. Bring her along.
See? You see what I mean?
Goodbye.
I think I do.
Seems to have taken care of that situation.
What next?
Hello? What do you want, Ed? It's about time you called. I got a delivery to make right away. Yeah. Fellow at Vine and Sunset wants an ounce, and he's in a hurry for it. How long will it take you? Well, can't you make it in less than half an hour? All right, scram on out there. Whose car are you going to drive? Well, what's the matter with Clara's Rolls? I told him you'd be driving that. All right, never mind. Get a hold of Bob and scram on out there. Come on.
Looks like Harry's right on the job, doesn't it?
Yes, and if we don't want to miss the show, we'll get on it.
Stopping only long enough to notify the bunco squad and the juvenile authorities, Chitwood and the reporter rushed to Vine and Sunset to be present when Powell made the buy from the suspected pair.
See Harry anywhere?
Yeah, right down there by the drugstore. Did you give him the money?
Yes, all in marked bills.
Now, as soon as Harry pays them the money, we'll hop on the running board and take him in.
You don't see a Rolls Royce anywhere, do you?
Uh-uh.
I don't know what this Bob guy looks like, but I'd know Ed if I met him on a dark night. He weighs 2 pounds less than a horse.
Hey, here comes the Rolls. Looks like they're going to pull into the curb.
You spotted Harry?
I think so.
Yeah, I see him now. He's got the stuff.
Come on, let's go. All right, Courtney, let's go.
What is this, a stick-up?
Never mind, just drive around the corner until I tell you to stop.
I don't know what this is all about. I don't know who you guys are. What do you want?
We want you to come down to headquarters and have your fingerprints taken.
What for?
For selling dope without a license.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Ask your talkative friend over there. Maybe he does.
Bob, do you know what they're talking about?
I ain't saying nothing.
Slightly ungrammatical, but clear. All right, Courtney, give me that money you got for the narcotic you just delivered.
I ain't got it.
No, but Bob has. Come on, shell out.
Give it to them, Bob.
Is that all of it, Carter?
Let me count it. Yeah, that's all of it. $250.
Is that the same money you gave Harry?
It's the money, all right. These are the babies we're after.
Where do you get your supply, Courtney?
I don't know what you're talking about.
I'll bet you don't.
How about your brother? Is he handling the stuff?
I don't know anything about it.
How about it, Bob?
I ain't saying nothing.
Yeah, I believe you mentioned that before. Okay, drive on.
Where to?
The city jail, my friend.
But Chitwood and his allies had nothing to connect dapper Don Courtney with the charge of dope peddling. The brother Ed obtained his release on bail, and the two Courtneys headed for St. Louis to spend the intervening time before Ed's trial. Meantime, police had arranged to trace the leads that had been obtained from their dictaphone. They brought in two girls for questioning.
I might just as well put my cards on the table and tell you two girls what I want. I'm after Don Courtney on a narcotics charge.
I'm afraid you come to the wrong place to get your information, Captain. We don't know anything about Don Courtney.
Why, I scarcely know Don at all.
I happen to know better than that. I've had calls on Courtney's phone traced to the apartment where you two girls live. I've had men watching your place night and day for several weeks. And if you want to tell me the truth, all right. If you want me to draw my own conclusions, that's all right, too. I have a pretty good idea what's going on.
Oh, yeah? Say, what are you driving at?
I happen to know that Ruth here is 18. And I also happen to know, Dorothy, that you're only 17. And a couple of Courtney's friends are even younger than you. However, I'm not interested in that angle of the case.
Yeah? Where does that get us?
Well, if you want to get tough about it, it gets jail for you. But if you want to play along with us, we can make it easy on you.
Well, what do you want to know?
Where's Courtney now?
He went to St. Louis with his brother.
When'll he be back?
I don't know. Sometime around New Year's.
That's next week, huh?
You figure fast, don't you?
Has Courtney ever given either of you girls narcotics?
No.
Just a minute. I heard enough over that dictaphone one afternoon to send both of you girls to jail.
What did you hear?
Well, I heard about a little crap game that you played with Mr. Courtney. I also heard him promise you an ounce of morphine as a bonus.
So that's where he was that night. Say, I ought to knock this dame's block off.
Oh, you didn't know about that, huh?
I'll tell you plenty about that lug. No, you won't. Because if you do, you'll get yourself in jail.
So will you.
Oh, no, I won't. Take a look at that.
Why, you dirty double-crossing...
Save it, sister, save
it.
Hey,
what's so interesting in that paper?
Read it yourself.
My. A marriage certificate. I suppose you're going to stand on your rights and not testify against your husband.
That's right, copper. I'm Mrs. Don Courtney, and I'm going to stay that way. And there's nothing you or anybody else can do about it. If you read that sheet of paper carefully, you'll see my mother was one of the witnesses. Now, what does that do to your case?
You forget there's still Dorothy.
I don't think you'll find Dorothy so willing to talk. Will he, Dorothy?
Oh, nuts to it. Save your breath, copper.
Hey, Paul.
What is it, Chief?
Take these two femme du pauvre out of here and keep them out.
Yeah, it's a pleasure, ain't he? Come on, get along, you two.
A week later, on the morning of New Year's Day, Captain Chitwood, Lieutenant Harry Powell, and four other officers drove to the railroad station in Pasadena to serve as a reception committee for the incoming Courtney and his brother.
Here he comes, boys. Watch him now. He's tough. Smith, you keep your eye on the train and see if his brother gets off on that side. If he does, Upside and Luckenbeck will get him. Robinson, you watch the back platform. Harry, come with me and we'll pick up Don.
Hey, you still going to try to pin a narcotic rap on him?
Yeah, we can't seem to get anybody interested in getting him on anything else.
The Corporation Commission didn't do anything about his whispering campaign?
No. There's something fishy about that bird, but I can't find out what it is. He knows too many people.
Yeah, maybe he's got a good lawyer.
Well, that wouldn't get him out of all his jams.
Wait a minute. I see him. He's fixing to get off.
Okay, let's keep this quiet now.
Where's Carter?
He's over there all set with the photographer. All right, Mr. Courtney. Take it easy now.
What?
We're police officers and you're under arrest.
Oh, yeah? Well, what's the charge?
Suspicion of narcotic violation.
What? Don't make me laugh.
We'll try not to. Take a look in those bags, Harry.
Okay. I'll get you for this, Chitwood.
Yeah, I thought it was about time you said that. How about it, Harry?
Pretty good, Eddie. 245 automatics and enough dope to send him to jail for the rest of his life.
Now, look, you're making a mistake, coppers. Those are not my bags.
No? Whose are they?
They belong to my brother.
What?
Hey, Harry, there's Courtney's brother in the vestibule. Grab him.
Okay, Chief.
Ride that train into Los Angeles and bring him in.
You're wasting your time, copper. You can't make this rap stick.
Maybe you're right, but I'll take a chance on it.
Although Powell searched every part of the train where he thought Ed Courtney might be hiding, the fugitive was not to be found for the simple reason that he had bribed a train employee to hide him in an upper berth. Don was led off and booked, but next day was out on bail, breathing threats against the police. Then, mysteriously, 4 days later, Brother Don surrendered Ed. Then started a story of the law's delays. Ed and his companion, who had been arrested carrying the marked money which the newspaper reporter had given Powell for the purchase of narcotics, had been released with ridiculously light sentences. Dapper Don managed to delay his trial time after time. And while he delayed, he was busy fixing things. Having already married one potential witness, he now managed to have the girl Dorothy disappear. And while a charge of tampering with witnesses was being considered, any hope of obtaining a conviction on a morals charge was shattered when the case was quietly dismissed. Insufficient evidence hampered the pressing of bunco charges. Courtney complained bitterly that newspapers and the publicity given his case had wrecked him financially. Then he sank to a lower form of crime, extortion.
Good morning, sister. Tell your boss I want to see him.
I'm very sorry, but Mr. Sullivan is quite busy right now. Would you care to wait?
Just take this envelope into him. I think he'll see me.
Yes, sir.
And never mind opening it. He can take care of that himself.
Yes, sir. I'll be right back.
You're telling me.
Mr. Sullivan will see you, Mr. Courtney.
Yeah. I thought he would. Hiya, Sullivan.
What do you want around here?
You read my note?
Yes, you lousy rat. I read it.
Well, I see you got my picture, too.
Where'd you get this picture?
Wouldn't you like to know?
I intend to.
Ah, come on. Let's cut out this child's play and get down to business. I admit you beat that rap on that morals case of yours. But how do you think the DA would like to see that picture?
You've got a lot of gall, but you haven't got nerve enough to do that. You're ripe for a little investigating yourself.
Oh, yeah?
It might be interesting for the district attorney to know how you beat your raps.
Maybe you would, Mr. Sullivan. But I'm afraid a man in your position can't afford to squeal on a guy like me.
All right. What's your proposition?
Now you're talking. I need $2,000 and somebody to square a beef with the Bunko Squad.
I'm a lawyer. I'm not in the beef squaring racket. Besides, where do you think I'm going to get $2,000 to give you?
Remember them bonds I spoke to you about? Go ahead and sell them.
The ones that you and your pals stole in Philadelphia?
Yeah, that's the one.
I told you once I wasn't going to touch those. They're hot. Now, you can take your filthy picture and take it to the district attorney, and you can do whatever you want with it.
I bet you wouldn't like for me to show that picture to your wife, I bet you.
Listen, Courtney. Someday I'm going to take that carnation out of your buttonhole, and I'm going to put it right on your nose.
Oh, yeah?
And then I'm going to mash it through the back of your head.
Why, Mr. Sullivan.
Mary, did you make that call I told you to?
Yes, Mr. Sullivan.
How about it, Sullivan?
Mary, write out a check for Mr. Courtney for $2,000 and bring it in here for me to sign.
Yes, sir.
Wait a minute. No check, Sullivan.
Never mind, Mary. Get the money out of my safe. I'll call you when I want it.
Now you're being smart. How about that Bunko beef?
What's it all about?
Just a little matter of some boys in Hollywood who didn't know how to run their business. I did a little telephoning now and then and got hold of some of their stock. You see, I represented the minority stockholders.
For a consideration, no doubt.
Well, 10%, maybe sometimes more. All depend on the sucker.
And you expect me to square a beef like that?
I not only expect you to, Mr. Sullivan, but I think you will.
Just what are you going to do if I don't?
Remember, I still have the negative from that picture you have there on your desk.
Nothing doing. I expect you to give me that negative when I give you the $2,000.
Mr. Sullivan, I know you believe in fairy tales, but I'm afraid I'll have to keep that negative, just in case.
No negative, no deal.
Okay, I'll show it to Wifey Difey.
Go right ahead. Go ahead.
All right, let's stop bluffing each other, Sullivan. I happen to know you've got your secretary listening in on that inter-office phone. But it isn't going to do you any good because you can't prove a thing.
Okay, Courtney. Mary, bring that money in here.
Yes, Mr. Sullivan.
Well, looks like you win this time, Courtney.
Yeah, I always win.
Here's the money, Mr. Sullivan.
Thank you, Mary. Here you are, Courtney.
Thanks, Sullivan. I always knew you were a smart guy.
That's right, Courtney. He is. He was smart enough to call the police when you came in.
Now, wait a minute. You ain't got nothing on me, Chitwood.
That's what you think. We've been listening to your conversation on that office phone, and the girl here has stenographic notes on every word you said. I may be a narcotics officer, but I can still take you in for grand theft, Bunko, and extortion. Come along. I think the DA wants to talk to you.
In just a moment, Chief Davis will give us the remaining facts regarding our program. Meanwhile, remember these facts. That Rio Grande cracked is just another way of saying police car performance gasoline, and that Rio Lube, its companion product, means complete and immediate protection for your motor the instant you step on the starter. For the sake of your motor and your pocketbook, use Rio Lube, the newest and finest motor oil sold in the West, and Rio Grande cracked, the gasoline that is first in public service. And now, Chief Davis.
In spite of Dapper Don's attempts to again clog the wheels of justice, he was nevertheless brought to trial on March 26, 1937. And because of two prior convictions, his sentence resulted in his being sent to Folsom Penitentiary for a period of 10 years and an additional sentence of 1 year to life. His was another crime that did not pay.
Thank you, Chief Davis.
Police calling all cars, attention all cars, and cancellation of broadcast 250. Suspects in this case is now in custody. That's all. Rosenquist.
This is your narrator, Frederick Lindsley, bidding you good night. For Rio Grande.
Calling All Cars, a copyrighted program created by Rio Grande.
Los Angeles Police calling all cars, attention all cars, broadcast 250 at the Dollar Line docks in Wilmington. See the officer. That's all. Rosenquist. Thank you.
this evening, Rio Grande presents Murder on the Left, with the well-known feature player of stage and screen, Grant Withers, as Don Colby.
The other day, I heard an old-timer say,
I tell you that Dad burned automobiles to blame for most of the crime. When the varmints had to make the getaway on horseback, they couldn't get so far.
Whether he is right or wrong, friends, this much is true. Law enforcement officers in California use good automobiles and the best gasoline money can buy. More fire engines, ambulances, and police cars are powered with Rio Grande cracked wherever it is sold than any other brand. California state and federal government officials also use Rio Grande crack to power their emergency public serving equipment. Benefit by the split-second starting, swift acceleration, the top power and speed, and amazing mileage of this better gasoline. So, friends, if you're getting anything less, if you want real police car performance in your car, set your compass for the nearest red and white Rio Grande station and get it with Rio Grande cracked, the most highly recommended public serving gasoline in the West.
Salient facts regarding our program tonight have been taken from records on file in the Los Angeles Police Department. We have therefore asked Chief of Police James E. Davis to open our program. Chief Davis.
It is the duty of every police department to furnish to its citizens as much protection as it can. Sometimes the work of a local peace officer will carry him far beyond the limits of his local jurisdiction. In such instances, it is necessary that he cooperate with local officials in whatever political division he may find himself. For after all, crime knows no political boundaries. Needless to say, crime is no more profitable outside the United States than it is in any of our local communities. The story we are to hear tonight took place in a foreign country, one that has always been friendly toward the United States in matters of law enforcement. We are proud, therefore, that one of our own officers could be instrumental in helping bring about the solution to the case. I shall have more to say regarding this at the end of the program.
Our scene opens on a bright April morning in 1930 in the office of Captain James Bean of the Los Angeles Homicide Detail.
Captain Bean, here's a letter I got with my mail this morning. And frankly, I don't like it.
I see it. Unless you leave $5,000 in unmarked bills at the viaduct on La Cienega Boulevard before noon tomorrow, you won't be able to finish that picture of yours. Any idea where this came from?
No, not the slightest. It was on my desk this morning when I came in.
Have you got any enemies?
Enemies? Do you know the motion picture business? Who hasn't?
Didn't this come through the mail?
Apparently not. Here's the envelope. It didn't have any stamp on it, but it was with the rest of my mail.
Anybody in your organization who might have sent it?
Well, I don't know. I just rent space in the studios where we've been shooting the picture. What worries me is this. This is the third note like this that I've had left on my desk in the last 3 weeks.
Well, why didn't you come in here before?
Why? Well, I didn't want any publicity to get out about it. You see, there are several things I wouldn't like to come out right now. And if a lot of publicity breaks, well, there's no telling what might happen.
Well, I don't exactly see where we come into the picture, Mr. Fish.
Huh?
No crime has been committed as far as our department is concerned. Though, if you'd like, we will assign an officer who can act as sort of a bodyguard.
Well, that's fine. That's exactly what I wish you'd do. And, by the way, I'll be willing to pay his expenses and pay for his services,
too.
Well,
that won't be necessary, Mr. Fish. It's our job to protect people.
Well, that's fine. Oh, yeah, Captain, there's one more thing. My company and I will be leaving in a couple of days for a little place in Lower California. We're going to shoot some scenes down there for a South Sea picture.
In Lower California?
Sure. We got a swell location down there. It's down close to La Paz. And what I wanted to ask you is this. Will it be all right if we take this officer along with us?
Sure. I've got a young fellow here who would be tickled to death to go. His name is Filkus. Joe Filkus.
Filkus? That's fine. I got a radio set by that name. You see, we'll only be gone a couple of weeks, but I don't want to take a chance on anything happening.
A week later, the producer and his small company are preparing for work in sweltering heat in Lower California.
Now, look here. You better go easy on them drinks, Dennis. This ain't Hollywood. You're in the tropics now, and whiskey in the tropics don't mix, you know.
Ah, don't worry about me, J.K. I never missed a picture cue in my life yet. Ask Colby here. Isn't that right, Donald, pal?
He's right, Mr. Fish. He's never missed.
yet.
Sure, but we got an important story conference tonight at my hotel. Carol Gifford's demanding a change in the script.
Oh, what's the matter with that girl? Going temperamental again down here, huh? Look, J.K., I'm the star of the South Sea picture we're making, see? Not Carol Gifford. That dizzy blonde
dame
doesn't...
Sure, Dennis. You're the star. But, you see, it's too late to make a change in the cast now. We start shooting first thing in the morning, you know.
Oh, all right. I'll be at your story conference tonight. We'll start shooting in the morning. Only go on away now. Let a couple of pals drink in peace,
will you? Okay, but you better show up tonight. The La Paz Hotel, room 400.
Yeah. La Paz Hotel. To have their hotel service and bellhops and flunkies even down here.
Yeah, here, have another drink, Dennis.
Yeah. Why can't they let their hair down and take a beach cottage like you and me, Don? This is the life. A grass shack, beach at your doorstep.
Sure, finish your drink.
Of course, the rocks cut your feet if you're not careful like it did mine this morning. It hurts, too. Still, this is the life, boy.
Go on, finish your drink.
Okay. And Don about Carol Gifford, sorry I blew up about her. Seems how you're kind of stuck on her. I didn't mean to.
Ah, skip it, Dennis. Carol doesn't even know I exist. Showed me as much on the boat coming down. Yeah, have another drink.
Yeah. What do you mean she doesn't know you exist?
Just that. She's got a star complex. Goes out with star players only.
Huh?
All the others don't count with her.
What do you mean, star players only? Well, you're just as much a star player as I am,
maybe.
Well, you are.
But I've never been starred in a picture yet. Second leads only for me, so far. But someday I'm gonna...
Look here, Colby, you got the stuff it takes to knock them over at the box office. Well, man, you got everything. Looks, personality...
Yeah? Well, it hasn't gotten me anywhere, Dennis. Anyway, let's forget it. Here, have another drink. A real one this time.
Yeah. What about you? Where's your glass?
I just finished mine. Besides, I haven't your constitution. You can take it. I can't.
You bet I can take it. And you know something, Donald, pal?
What?
When we get back to Hollywood, I'm going to see that Sam Goldman gives you a break. A real break.
Thanks, Dennis, but it's no use. Mm-hmm. Nah. It's no use. I got to make my own breaks. And it's got to be away from Hollywood.
Yeah.
Away from Hollywood.
Sorry to be late for the conference, Mr. Fish, but you see,
Where's Dennis Clark? Didn't Dennis come with you?
Well, that's what made me so late, Mr. Fish. I tried to sober Dennis up, but he was too drunk to come.
Too drunk? And after me warning him to keep sober...
Of all dinner. And on my picture, too, at that.
I'm sorry, Miss Gifford. I tried my best to keep him from drinking, but he wouldn't listen to me. Kept on fighting for the whiskey.
This is a fine how-do-you-do. 500 miles on location, and he's got to get cockeyed.
He'll ruin my picture. That's what he'll do, Sam.
Well, if there's anything I can do, Miss Gifford.
Oh, no, there's nothing you or... Say. Sam, I've got an idea.
What? Again?
Why don't you use this fellow here? This, what's your name?
Colby. Don Colby.
Oh, yes, Don Colby. Use him in Clark's place, Sam. He's just as tall, just as good-looking.
Colby? No, not Colby.
But why not?
He hasn't got a box office name. That's why he's too risky, Carol.
But I'm sure I can turn in a good performance, Mr. Fish. And I know you won't regret giving me the break.
Say, wait a minute. I thought you and Clark were pals.
Well, we are, but business is business.
And that's what I say also, Sam. You know that. You can't mix social life with a career. Or can you? If Dennis Clark prefers to guzzle whiskey,
it'll be... Yeah, no, Carol, but this is no time for experiments. I got a $250,000 production on my hands. $500 my own money. And if I don't use Dennis Clark...
Very well. Have it your own way, darling. You're the producer. But if it was me,
sure, I know. But look, Carol, and you too, Colby. We've got a lot of work ahead of us. Come on, let's go over the script. Clark can get the changes first thing in the morning. You can sober him up by then, can't you, Colby?
Yeah, I think I can.
You think you can?
Well, I mean, I know I can.
And that's better.
You won't have to worry about Dennis, Mr. Fish. I'll start working on him as soon as I get home tonight. midnight and still drunk. The famous Dennis Clark, stewed to the gills. Well, snore on, fella. It won't be long now. Getting you cockeyed didn't work as I hoped it would. Well, there's still another way. Yeah, the sure way. Come on, up on your feet, you drunken fool.
Sir, what's going on?
Shut up and stand on your feet.
That's you, Don, old pal?
Yeah, it's your old pal, Don, just back from the story conference at the hotel. And you're going to help me be a star, see?
Star, old pal.
Yeah, me. Me and you are going to do things tonight.
How about a drink?
Later. First, I've got to set this clock back an hour and a half, back to 10:45. And then I'll tip this table over, whiskey bottles, glasses, clock and all, and the clock will stop at 10:45. Get it? It'll look like you did it in a drunken stagger.
What are you celebrating, Donald, pal? Let me in. Let's have a drink. Give me a drink.
Next, I'll tear down these door drapes, and that'll look as if you tore them on your way out to the beach. There. The left drape. I mustn't forget you're left-handed, eh, Clark?
How about a little drink? Let's have a drink. I want to celebrate, too.
You'll get your drink, Clark. Here, lift up your foot.
Hey, what are you taking my shoes off for?
Oh, we're going for a little walk, Clark. It's nice and cool outside, and you won't need these rubber sneakers.
You're a great guy, Don. You're a swell pal. A real pal.
There. I got your sneakers off. We'll leave them here. I'll take off mine, too. Okay, let's go. Here, keep off the grass. Don't step on the sand. That's it. Along this lawn.
Drunken
idiot. Acting like a fool. Well, here we are, Dennis. The rocky ledge. There. Watch your step. Easy. Okay. Now get on my back. I'm going to carry you through the shallow water here, all the way back to a spot on the beach just in front of the shack.
Piggyback. All right, Don, old pal. Let's go piggybacking. Piggybacking my old pal.
Don't shake so much. I don't want you falling off and getting your feet and your clothes wet. Here we are. Just the spot. Straight in line with the shack's beach door. Wait. Don't get off. I want your feet dry, not wet.
What about that drink, Donald, pal? I need a drink.
In a few minutes now, Clark. It's too bad you're too drunk to appreciate the details. Else you'd learn what a perfect crime this is going to be.
Don't know how drunk I am.
You won't be singing along, you fool. Not with your head deep in the water and your legs stretched out on the sand. Well, here you go. Feet first. That's perfect. Stretched out like a perfect stiff.
Say, who hit me?
Nobody hit you, Clarky, old pal. Just lie there quietly. You're going to help me to eliminate you. Help me to take your place as the star of the picture you're doing tomorrow. You want to help me, don't you?
Sure, you want a drink. Anything, Donald, boy, old boy.
You fool, I'm going to kill you. And after you're stretched out here dead with your head in the water, I'm going back to the shack the same way I came. And I'm going to put on your shoes, your rubber sneakers, and then stagger like a drunk over the sand from the house to here. The last footprints will look as if you actually fell flat on your face, see? Like you fell headfirst in the water and drowned. Because when I'm finished making those prints in the sand, I'm going to stand on your body and lace your rubber sneakers back on your feet. Get it, Clark? The perfect murder.
I want a drink. I want a drink. I don't want a whistle. Come on, let me have it. Let's go get a little.
It's right here, a belly full of ocean.
Hey, what? It's cold. Don, what's that?
Quit living, you fool. It's too late now. Get your head back under that water. I've got to do it, Dennis. It's the only way Fish will ever give me the lead in that picture. Yeah, quit your wriggling.
For God's sake, stop it. You're drowning me.
You've got to die. This time your head goes under the stay. A couple of more minutes and it'll be over. 1 second. Two, three,
four, five, six, seven.
2 hours later, just before dawn, Mr. Fish is aroused by violent pounding on his door.
Mr. Fish, wake up! Wake up, Mr. Fish!
Who is it?
It's me, Colby. Open the door, Mr. Fish. It's important. Please hurry.
All right, we'll look at my bathroom, man.
What is this, Colby? It's a fine time to...
Say, what's the matter? You look like you've seen a ghost.
It's Dennis Clark, Mr. Fish. He's dead.
What?
Yeah, dead. Drowned. I saw him stretched out on the beach. I tried to revive him, but I couldn't.
But are you sure he's dead? Did you call a doctor?
No, I came here first. I thought maybe...
Well, we better get a doctor right away. Here, come on in. Close the door. I'll get him on the phone right away. Load the rotten bricks. Happened to me. This is... Hello. Hello, operator. Operator, get me a doctor, quick. What? I don't care if he is a French doctor. Any doctor, only get him quick. Yeah, and rush him out to, say, what's the number out there?
It's the only house near the rock ledge.
Yeah, it's the only house near the rock ledge. You can't miss it. And ask him to hurry. There's a man worth $250,000 to me drowning there. Ask him to hurry, yeah. And operator, call Joe Filkus. I'll meet him there. Yeah, operator, have a taxi waiting downstairs for me. I'll be down in a minute, yeah. Well, Colby, this is a fine mess I'm in now. Here, throw me them pants, will you?
I did what I could. I found him on the beach
sure,
like that.
Sure. I know. I'm not blaming you. Only this is a fine time for him to get drowned, just when I'm ready to start shooting. Well, doctor, what's the verdict? You already examined him.
Yes, and he's dead, Mr. Fish. Asphyxiation of the lungs.
Asphyxiation? Well, what's that?
Drowned. Suffocation by water.
Then you mean that, being drunk, he staggered out here to the edge of the water, flopped over, and was drowned?
Apparently so, Mr. Colby. However, that's for the judge to decide at the inquest. Careful where you step, gentlemen. The police will want to verify those staggering footprint markings in the sand to establish the official cause of death, you know.
God, this is terrible. Dennis was such a swell guy. A great pal.
Yeah, and now your pal, my star, is stiff like a board. Just a black shadow on a moonlight beach.
I've already sent my driver up to the judge. Should be here any minute now.
And the police?
Naturally. Mr. Clark is a celebrity. The police won't miss out on this, you can bet. Is there any other member of your company that knows the deceased? Questions to be asked by the authorities, you know.
Well, yes, there's Carol Gifford. She was the co-star with Clark.
Well, we better not have Miss Gifford see Dennis like this, Mr. Fish. You know how upset she gets.
Yeah, I was thinking of that.
Such being the case, gentlemen, as a doctor, I'd advise getting in touch with the lady before the police do.
Well, what sort of police do they have here?
I imagine, gentlemen, you'll find the police here quite an efficient corps.
Well, and that should be simple enough, a drunk having an accident. What do you think, Doc?
Well, so far as my examination is concerned, yes. A simple accidental death. Oh, there's a car pulling up in front. That must be the judge now. Out here, Judge. Around the back, on the beach.
Hello, Dr. Sorrell. Very wretched hour to be out on a case, is it not? 2 o'clock and just... Oh, hello. You have some friends with you, Doctor.
No. That is... these gentlemen are friends of the deceased. This is Mr. Fish.
How do you do?
And this is Mr. Colby.
How do you do?
Judge Padilla, gentlemen.
You determined the cause of death, no doubt, Doctor.
Yes, asphyxiation of the lungs caused by an excess of water.
Accidental?
Apparently so. There being no head wounds. Of course, a further examination of the body itself might prove otherwise. Mr. Colby here says that the deceased was intoxicated earlier in the evening.
Intoxicated? He was just plain drunk.
It seems there is nothing more mystifying here than a very sad case of an unfortunate, foolish imbiber of alcohol.
That's fine.
What did you say?
I mean, it's fine. There won't be any bad publicity. You see, we have a picture, a moving picture.
Of course. I read this much in the local papers.
Oh, you did?
Well, gentlemen, it's a bit chilly out here. If we can go in the cottage.
Oh, yeah, sure, of course. Come right in. And, oh, Mr. Fish, you'd better get over and get Carol. I mean Miss Gifford, and prepare her for what's coming off.
Carol!
Who is it?
It's me, honey, J.K.
What do you want? I'm sleepy.
It's very important, Carol. Please, open the door.
Oh, all right, hold your horses. I'll be there in a minute. Well, what's so darn important about waking a girl up at 2:30 in the morning?
It's about Dennis Clark. He's dead.
What? Say that again.
I think he's been murdered.
Who?
Dennis Clark.
Dennis Clark? Well, are you sure? Who told you? Well, have you seen him? Oh, here, come in.
Who told you? Are you sure? Yeah, he's dead. Drowned like a rat.
Drowned? Say, are you drunk? Clark murdered, then he's drowned. Was this your idea of a joke?
No, it's no joke, honey. Get your clothes on. The police want to question all of us, you included.
Police? Then you are serious.
I'll say I am. Plenty serious, and you better not...
Me? Say, you're not getting me into any mess, Clark. Clark murdered, and you want me, your own girlfriend, to stick a pretty neck right into it. Say, what have I got to do with it?
You don't understand, honey. I'm trying to keep you out of any scandal or excitement. That's why I'm here, before the police get to you.
Fish and Miss Gifford returned to the cottage where Lieutenant Filkus had begun an investigation.
Right here, honey. Well, I guess everybody's here now. Let's see.
I'm sorry to keep you waiting so long, Lieutenant, but Miss Gifford was quite upset when I went for
her. Yeah. That's okay, Mr. Fish. I understand.
Thank you.
Anyway, I was doing some private investigation on the beach. Good thing you folks didn't come too soon and disturb my investigation.
But I thought all murder mysteries were investigated by the police.
For the present, I've got this case.
Pardon me, Lieutenant, but I believe I'm no longer required here, so if you will excuse me, I shall go home to bed.
Oh, no. Don't go to sleep yet, Judge. Wait a while. I think I'm going to need you for something pretty soon.
But, Lieutenant, I have completed my examination. As far as I'm concerned, death was caused from asphyxiation of the lungs due to accidental drowning.
Yeah, sure, Judge. Looks like plain case of accident. Just the same, stick around, please. I'm going to need you.
Well, Joe, do you mind speeding up the investigation a bit?
Yeah, please do, Joe. I'm sure Miss Gifford would also want it over as quickly as possible.
Don't mind me, Lieutenant Filkus. Go right ahead. I'd like to see how you detectives work.
Thank you, ma'am. I'll show you how a detective works. Well, Colby, what have you got to say?
Go ahead. But I've told you all I know already. Dennis Clark and I were friends, pals. We lived here in the shack together. We've been drinking together ever since we got here. Well, tonight was the same. Excepting that Clark wanted to get drunk. Said he didn't want to sit around listening to the story conference that Mr. Fish had scheduled for the night.
Anything else, Colby?
Oh, no, I don't think so.
If you were pals with Mr. Clark, like you say, why didn't you stay here and get drunk with him?
Why should I? I've got my career to think about.
Oh, I see. Now we're getting to the bottom of this case.
I didn't say that.
No, you didn't. That's something I figured out for myself. You were the second lead. So with him dead, you'd get to be the star.
Have it your own way. I went to the conference and was there until close to midnight. Mr. Fish can confirm that.
That's right, Joe. Colby left close to midnight, all right.
I didn't ask the time, gentlemen, but that's a good point. Good for you, Colby. Because when this clock I've got in my hand smashed on the floor, it stopped at 10:45, quarter to 11. So your time alibi is perfect.
Well, that's that.
Yeah, looks like this is going to be an easy case to solve.
Aren't you going to arrest anyone?
I don't know. I've got some more questions first. Miss Gifford, was Mr. Clark your friend? I mean, a good friend?
Well, you see, Lieutenant...
What she means, Joe, is that she knew Clark as a business associate. Yeah, business associate. That's good. Nothing personal about it, you understand? Nothing personal at all. Just co-stars in the same studio, that's all.
I get it. And, Mr. Colby, Miss Gifford, how about him?
He means absolutely nothing to me. Nothing at all.
Absolutely nothing. Nothing at all. That's right.
Jealousy, eh?
What do you mean by that crack?
Just this, Colby. You're in love with Miss Gifford. And she was more friendly with Clark.
That's a lie.
No, that's the truth. I can see it in your face. Every time you look at Miss Gifford, you look like a sick cat.
Look here, you flatfoot. Are you accusing me of murdering my pal in order to get Miss Gifford?
Oh, then you share my suspicion, Colby. You believe Clark was murdered. You know he was murdered.
Joe, I think you're right. I'm almost positive Colby killed Dennis Clark.
What, you believe it too?
Of course I do.
Yep, Mr. Fish believes it. But I have some proof.
All right, let's have it. How could I know Clark was murdered?
I have a piece of tape here. It's got a red smear on it. I found it near Clark's body on the beach.
So what?
This piece of adhesive tape slipped off a cut on Clark's foot. The left foot, under the heel. Do you see what I mean? Yet?
No, I don't.
I can prove that there was a crime committed.
Maybe. But what can a piece of adhesive plaster mean to me?
It could mean a murder charge for you.
You mentioned murder once before. Any proof of it?
Plenty of proof, Mr. Colby.
You mean you can pin it on Colby, Joe?
I think so.
Yeah.
Well, I'm listening, but you better make it good. Go ahead.
My deduction is very simple, although I admit that the single track of footprints in the sand had me fooled for a long time, almost a half hour. They look so perfect, like a real drunk man could make. And the footprints matched the dead man's shoe almost like a glove. It did look like a plain case of accidental drowning, like Dr. Sorrell said.
Well, go ahead.
Well, after, I think some more. I decided the murderer had walked through the water. Then he took off Clark's shoes, then made those perfect footprints. Then he stepped on the body to put the shoes back on. And when he switched the shoes back to Mr. Clark's feet, the piece of adhesive tape, which was inside one of the shoes, fell off in the sand in the dark accidentally.
Now, that's impossible.
No. No, it isn't. I've got it, Joe. Once you knew about the plaster gauze, you knew someone had unlaced Clark's shoes and put them on again. And after it was over, the murderer must have jumped from the body into the water.
Mm-hmm.
What the scenario? I'm going to film it right away.
That's right. And the killer cut his feet on the sharp rocks in the water. You mind if we examine your feet, Mr. Colby?
Well, sure. Why not?
No. The left one, please.
Oh, very well. Well, there you are. Sure, I've got a cut on my left foot. Who wouldn't get hurt swimming out here? Well, even Clark had a cut, but that doesn't prove anything.
Lift your feet some more, please. I want to look at the bottom of them.
Well, is that high enough?
Yeah. And now you're under arrest, Colby, for the murder of Dennis Clark.
Oh no, you don't. I suspected this, and
yeah.
I'll kill you first. Same as I killed Clark. Stand back, you fool!
Nice work, Doctor. You winged him nicely. Now I'll tell you why I ask you to wait, Doc. Please examine Colby's foot. No, not the rock cut. Just examine the left heel, Doctor. Isn't that a McCruricome strain on the skin of the heel?
Well, yes, Mr. Filkus. It is McCruricome.
Same as on this piece of adhesive plaster that fell out of Clark's shoes, eh?
Yes, the same.
Sure, and when Colby put on Clark's shoes, inside the left shoe was this piece of plaster with a McCruricome on it. Colby didn't know that. He used the shoes, then he switched them again. The plaster fell off. Well, Cinderella, it looks like you stepped into the wrong shoes.
In just a moment, Chief Davis will conclude our program.
And before Chief Davis closes this case, just a brief reminder that those who drive the most and know the most about gasoline depend on the police car performance of Rio Grande Cracked, and that the lubricant that can't break down is Rio Lube, the newest and finest motor oil sold in the West. You'll find them both at your independent Rio Grande dealers tomorrow.
And now, Chief Davis.
Colby was arrested and turned over to the Mexican authorities. He was tried and given the sentence prescribed by law. Because of his American citizenship, however, his sentence was somewhat lightened. But so far as we know, he has never returned to the United States, nor did he ever reap any profit from his crime.
Thank you, Chief Davis.
Los Angeles police calling all cars, attention all cars, a cancellation broadcast 250. Suspects in this case delivered to Mexican authorities for punishment. That's all. Rosenquist.
Grandy has presented Murder on the Left, with Grant Withers featured as Don Colby. This is your narrator, Barry Kroger, bidding you good night for Rio Grande. Calling all cars, a copyrighted program created by Rio Grande.
Los Angeles County Sheriff's Office calling all cars. Attention all cars to broadcast 251 regarding a holdup. Be on the lookout for a suspect described as male American, 6 feet 4 inches. Weight about 150 pounds. This man believed to be wounded in a holdup this day. That's all. Rosenquist.
The Calling All Cars programs are not fairy tales, but the careful presentation of dramatic facts. We observe the same principle in telling the story of Rio Grande Cracked Gasoline. When you were told that Rio Grande crack is the motor fuel of police car performance, it is supported by facts which no one can deny. Here are some of them.
Rio Grande cracked powers more police cars, fire engines, ambulances, and other emergency equipment wherever it is sold than any other brand.
And that's not all.
In addition to a vast majority of your city and county officials, many heads of your California state and federal governments also prefer Rio Grande cracked to power their emergency automotive equipment.
And the reason for this overwhelming endorsement by those who drive the most and thus know the most about gasoline is that Rio Grande cracked has proved to be quicker starting, smoother in acceleration, with greater power and maximum speed, giving the kind of mileage that saves the money of taxpayers like you and me. And so, if you're more interested in gasoline facts than in gasoline fairy stories, drop around at the red and white Rio Grande station in your neighborhood and get the most highly recommended gasoline in the West.
The story we are to hear tonight is to be found in the confidential files of the Office of the Sheriff of Los Angeles County. We have therefore asked Sheriff Eugene Biscaluz to open our program.
The cases you hear on Calling All Cars are not all necessarily good detective stories. It's not essential that a true story such as these cases present contain all the elements of a detective thriller. Most criminals are stupid. They make blunders. Our deputy sheriffs, by common sense and hard work, take advantage of these blunders. There isn't a genius in the sheriff's office. Yet we have solved more than 99% of the cases coming under our jurisdiction. Ours is the job of proving to the criminal that crime is a losing game, and we do it. The secret of being a detective lies in being able to see the mistakes a criminal makes and in being able to take advantage of these facts. The first mistake any criminal ever makes is in committing his crime. We shall hear tonight how this one mistake led to a lot of grief for the men involved.
Hot dog payday again.
Yeah, a lot of good that's going to do you. The way you throw your dough away, you won't have a cent by tomorrow night.
Don't worry about me, Mr. Morganbilt. I don't see you driving to work in Rolls Royces.
Yeah? Well, I'm not riding buses either, wise guy. You're going to cash that check tonight?
Yeah, and how?
At Burke's?
Sure. What's 15 cents in my young life? I don't mind paying a service charge.
Well, come on, I'll drive you by. Guess I might as well cash my check tonight, too.
Hiya, Burke. Got any folding money around this joint?
I think I might find you a little.
Okay, my man. There you are, all signed and endorsed.
You get a raise?
Yep, making $35 a week now.
That's fine. I like to see you young fellas get ahead. You'll be getting married pretty soon, won't you?
That guy? Oh, who'd marry him?
Well, you never can tell. Now, there you are, Joe. $34.85 for you and 15 cents for me.
Thanks, John.
Yours $35 too, Bill?
Yep, here it is.
Say, how's the missus, Bill?
Oh, she's fine.
I saw her going by yesterday, but she didn't stop. And say, that's a fine youngster you got, Bill. You want to take good care of him.
No, don't worry. I will.
You'd think that was the only kid in California, the way Bill raves about him.
Well, you can't understand that, Joe. Not yet. Wait till you have one of your own.
Wait.
Well, goodbye, boys, and see you next Friday.
So long, John.
Bye, Burke.
Bye. Hey, is that clock right, Mary?
Yes, sir. 7 o'clock, Mr. Burke. Would you like another cup of coffee?
No, thanks. No, I think I've had enough. Got to start cutting down past 50, you know, and I have to watch the old blood pressure now.
I guess you do at that. Yeah. That'll be 26 cents altogether.
26. Well, there you are, Mary.
Thank you. Be back for lunch, Mr. Burke?
Maybe so. I don't know how busy I'll be yet. May have you bring my lunch over.
Oh, be glad to. Bye.
Bye, Mary. I guess I better clean this place up a little. Good morning. Can I help you?
Maybe. You cash checks here?
I certainly do. That's my business.
Well, I got one I want cashed.
Come right back here to the office, then.
Yeah. It's a nice place you got here.
Yeah.
Always keep this iron door locked?
Yeah, most of the time.
Keep right on going or I'll blast you.
Hey, what is this?
Never mind closing that door. Sit down.
Everything okay, Fred?
Yeah, come on in.
Al's waiting in the car. He's getting nervous.
Well, tell him to keep his shirt on. No, come on in. Help me. I said sit down, Mug.
Hey, take it easy, young fella.
Button your lip. What's the combination of that safe?
I don't know.
Don't feed me that gas.
I'm telling you the truth. I don't know the combination.
Well, maybe this rod will make you remember.
Anyway, the safe has a time lock on it, and you couldn't get it open for another 30 minutes.
Okay. We'll wait. Gag him, Frank.
Okay.
Better leave his hands free so he can turn that dial for us.
You can do it yourself.
And leave fingerprints all over the place? Don't try to be funny, guy. Gag him, Frank.
Hey, you got a clean hanky, mister?
Boy, does he look funny with that rag in his mouth. Now open that safe.
Maybe he's got the combination worked on somewhere.
Yeah, it's an idea. How about it, monkey? Yeah, let's look in these desk drawers over here.
Look out, Fred!
Hey, beat it, Frank! Okay, monkey, I'll finish it.
It looks like everybody in South Los Angeles is out here.
Uh-huh. Well, they haven't had a good killing out here in years.
There's Welch from the Huntington Park Station.
Yeah, I see Armstrong's with him, too.
Oh, Welch. What's all the excitement out here?
Hello, Killian. How are you, Mahoney?
Hi.
You know Armstrong?
Yeah, hi. Sure.
Two bodies, but which one's the bandit?
The short guy. The other one's John Burke. He's a sort of banker around here. Cashes paychecks.
Looks like the crook got it right through the heart.
Yeah, we figured that Burke was sitting in this chair here. He must have fired over his shoulder, judging from the position of the bandit's body. You see, here's a bullet hole in Burke's right cheek.
Yeah, evidently shot twice, though, because it's obvious that the shot in the top of the head is the one that killed him.
That's right. That's why I figure he fired over his shoulder. The man he killed must have been to his left, and there must have been another fellow on the right.
Well, there aren't any guns except this one that belonged to Burke. We found these three bullets. One, evidently, is the one that killed this hold-up man. This one we dug out of the wall over there.
Must be the one that killed Burke.
That's the way we figured it.
Where'd the third one come from?
We found it over there by that steel door.
Looks like it's got blood on it.
And Burke must have hit the other bandit, too.
Well, that's what we think. That bird there has only one bullet wound in him. Since this bullet's bloody, stands to reason that the other man is hit, too.
Are we sure there was another man?
Yeah, pretty sure. The fellow who was just going into the cafe next door when all the shooting started told us that he saw a tall man run out of Burke's office here and that the man limped badly.
Tall man, huh?
Yeah, this fellow said the guy must have been 6 feet or more.
Did he have a gun, or did this fellow notice?
Yeah, had a gun in his hand. He piled into a car that was parked in front with another fellow at the wheel, and the car turned down the alley next door and beat it.
You know, there's a bare possibility that this fellow here was a customer of Burke's.
Sort of innocent bystander, huh?
About that?
No, not very likely. They found this roll of wire in his coat pocket and these rubber gloves and this heavy knife.
Well, it looks like they were about to tie Burke up.
That's the way it looks to us.
Now, here's a pillow slip that we found in the other pocket of his overcoat. The name of the apartment it came from is stitched into the hem there.
Bavaria Apartments, 843 South Maple. Well, that ought to be a cinch to trace.
Yeah.
Well, we'll send this fellow in for a postmortem. Maybe his fingerprints will identify him.
That's a good idea. We'll get Frank Gomper to run a ballistics test on these bullets and find out which one killed him. Meantime, I think we better take a look at the Bavaria Apartments.
Checking with the manager of the apartment house regarding the slain bandit, Killian and Mahoney received the information.
No one like that lives here. Don't know who stole Flittle Slip.
At the morgue, the dead man's fingerprints were taken and compared with files in the police department as well as in the sheriff's office. It was learned...
These prints belong to Frank Eller, convicted of theft, California Motor Vehicle Code, drunkenness, petty theft, address unknown.
Armed with this information, Killian and Mahoney returned to the apartment house to continue their investigation.
What you want now?
We want to know if you have a fellow living here, a very tall man, over 6 feet.
Oh, yes. Tall man, he live here. Apartment 41. I'll show you. Right back here, please.
How long has this man lived here?
Oh, not long. Week, 10 days, maybe.
What's his name?
Hamilton, his name, he tell me.
What's his first name?
Fred, I think it is.
Fred Hamilton, huh?
Here's the apartment, please. It's not locked.
Empty.
Yeah, but it speaks volumes, Paul.
I'll say. Take a look at the blood on that bed.
Oh, so here's one of my good towels. All soaked with blood.
Here's a real find, Will.
Yeah?
Here's a pair of pants I found in the trash basket.
Take a look at the length of these.
I go back to office, priest.
Well, unless I miss my guess, that's blood on those pants, too.
Sure it is. And here's a bullet hole right below the waistband, front and back.
Huh. Bullet went right through him.
Looks that way.
Judging from the length of these pants, I'd say this bird's 6.5 feet tall at least.
I'd just as soon have these as a picture of the guy.
Uh-oh. Here's something.
What'd you find?
Iodine swabs and old bandages.
Well, looks like Hamilton's the man we're looking for.
Yeah, but where to look, that's another question.
Well, oh, here's another pair of pants.
Yeah?
Maybe these will turn up something. Yep, take a look at this.
What is it?
Property tag from the General Hospital, dated December 25th, 1937. Well, that's just about a month ago.
Patient number 83564, Ward 5200. Name Frank Ellers. See, that is something.
Hey, wait a minute, there's something written on the back.
Yeah, I see it. Fred, 843 South Maple Street, apartment 41. Frank here at 7 a.m. Well, that definitely puts a third man in the picture.
Yeah, assuming that Fred is Hamilton and Frank is Ellers.
The guy who left this note's probably the man who drove the car when Burke was killed.
Well, one thing's certain. Hamilton will have to contact a doctor sooner or later. We better get this description to the hospitals and all the doctors.
We better check with the General Hospital about this Ellers guy, too. We'll phone him and tell him we're coming. We'd like to see the record on Frank Ellers, the man we phoned you about.
Oh, surely. Here it is. Right here.
Thank you. Patient suffering from bruises and contusions resulting from street fight. Condition intoxicated.
We couldn't get an address on this patient. That is, not a definite one. He gave East First Street as his residence, but no number.
Do you have a record of visitors this man might have had?
No, we haven't any record of that.
Well, look, just for luck, let's find out if you ever had a patient in here named Fred Hamilton.
Oh, that may be a bit difficult. We have our records bound according to years, and they're arranged alphabetically. If you'd care to look at them, you may.
We'd care to.
Yeah.
Right in here, please. Now you'll find all the records in these files right here. Just help yourself.
Yeah, thanks, we will.
Well, looks like we'll be here till spring.
Oh, it won't take so long.
I don't know about that. Well, I can't find any Fred Hamiltons in 1936.
I haven't found any in 1937 either.
Yeah, you couldn't use a Joe Hamilton, could you?
No, I don't think so.
No Fred Hamiltons in that one. I'll try 1935.
Well, hand me 1934. There's nothing in this one.
All right. There you are.
Boy, I'm glad we're not looking for John Smith.
Ever try finding a guy named Johnson?
No. Why?
Most common name in the English language.
Yeah? Well, there's no Fred Hamilton's in this book. Give me 32.
Okay, I'll take 33. Hey, it's getting darker outside. Looks like rain.
Yeah, that'd be fine. Traipsing around in the rain looking for a 6.5-foot murderer.
It's bad enough looking for anyone.
Hey, wait a minute. Here's a Fred Hamilton. Admitted in 1932, arthritis. Worked at Noah Beery's Trout Club up in the High Sierras.
You suppose it's too much to hope this is the guy we're after?
I don't know. It's a lead, anyway. According to this record, he was married.
Oh, our luck couldn't hold out on that, though. He couldn't have been married here.
Never can tell. We're not going to pass up any bet.
Once more began the long siege of checking musty records. Back in the pages of the marriage license record books, Killian and Mahoney scanned every line looking for the name of Fred Hamilton. At last, in 1928, the record showed that Hamilton had married Edna Enders. As a final point of search, Killian and Mahoney chose the city directories. In the directory for 1937 appeared the name of Edna Enders and her address.
Hey, I'm getting awfully fed up with ringing doorbells.
Oh, it might be worse.
How?
You might be selling brushes.
Oh, yeah, or magazines. I wonder if this dame's home.
Yes?
Oh, are you Mrs. Fred Hamilton?
Well, who are you?
Sheriff's deputies, Bureau of Investigation. My name's Killian. We're trying to locate a Mrs. Fred Hamilton. Her name was Enders before she married Hamilton.
Come on in, please.
Thank you. This is Deputy Mahoney, my partner.
How do you do?
How are you, ma'am?
I'm the person you're looking for.
Oh.
However, I'm not Mrs. Hamilton. Fred and I have been divorced for some time. That's why I took back my old name.
Are you married now?
Yes, I've been married several months.
Well, then you don't know where Hamilton is now, huh?
No, I don't. May I ask why you're looking for him?
We're pretty certain he killed a man.
Oh.
And you don't know where he is?
No. If I did, I'd tell you. He's guilty. I hope you catch him, but I haven't seen him in months. Say, why don't you check with his mother and sister? They live here. I don't know where they do live, but his sister works downtown. I can give you the name of the firm, and you can contact her.
Yeah, we'd appreciate it if you would.
You don't have any pictures of Hamilton lying around, do you?
No, but I have some negatives of old snapshots. You can have those if you want them.
Say, we do.
Say, incidentally, Fred has two brothers in Texas. One's living at Alney, and the other lives at Abilene.
Oh, you know their names?
Well, I think Ed lives at Alney, and Charlie lives in Abilene.
Ed and Charlie. Well, we'll have the Texas officers keep a watch on the brothers' homes. Maybe Fred will show up there.
Yeah. Oh, I almost forgot the negatives. Here they are.
Thank you. We'll take care of them and get them back to you.
Oh, you can keep them for all I care. Or throw them away. I don't care if I never see or hear from that man again.
Dispatching telegrams to the police in the towns where Hamilton's brothers lived, Killian and Mahoney continued their investigation in Los Angeles. Next morning, Killian phoned Hamilton's sister.
Yeah, I hate to do this, but we've got to catch this monkey.
The end justifies the means. That's the way I look at it.
Hold it.
This is Lydia Hamilton.
Oh, Miss Hamilton, I hate to bother you at work, but I just got in from Abilene, and your brother Charlie told me to get in touch with Fred, but he didn't know where Fred was staying.
You liar.
Shut up.
Well, that's fine.
I wonder if I might take a run out and talk with you.
I'm sure she'd like to hear about Charlie.
Oh, that'd be fine. Where can I get in touch with her?
Well, she's working in a drugstore down on East 7th, near Los Angeles Street. You know where that is?
Well, I think I can find it.
Until the world began.
Well, you can get in touch with her, and then whatever she wants to do will be all right with me.
All right, that's what I'll do.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Well, this thing's getting complicated. Now I've got to go down to lie to Hamilton's mother.
You fellas wait here in the car.
What'll it be today, young man?
A cup of coffee, please.
Cream?
Yes, cream, please. Are you Mrs. Hamilton?
Why, yes, I am.
Well, my name's Killian. Mm-hmm. I talked to your daughter over the phone a while ago. She told me where I'd find you.
But why were you looking for me?
Maybe I'd better explain. You see, I just got in from Abilene. I knew your son, Charlie.
Oh, of course. Well, how is Charlie?
Why, he's swell.
Oh.
He wanted me to look you up when I got out here and say hello and all that sort of thing.
I get off at 3. It's almost that time now. Why don't you wait and go out to the house with me? I'd like to have you meet my other boy, Fred, and Lydia.
Oh, is Fred living with you now?
Why, yes. He's been staying with us 2 or 3 days now.
Well.
Of course, it's a small place, and we're sort of crowded. But Fred hasn't been feeling well, and I wanted to have him where I could keep an eye on him.
Yes, some boys are a trial to mothers.
Oh, Fred's a good boy. Never been in any trouble at all. Oh, he drinks a little now and then, but nothing serious.
Well, no, I wouldn't think he would, having a mother like you.
Oh, well, I've tried to do the best I knew how about it, children. Oh, Charlie's a fine boy, don't you think?
Oh, yes. Charlie's a swell guy.
And I want you to meet Lydia, too. She's a fine girl. Oh, she's going to be married soon, though.
Is that so?
Uh-huh, and I just don't know what I'll do. Lydia and Fred have always been my babies, sort of. And when she leaves, well, I'll just kind of be lost, I reckon.
Well, but there's still Fred.
Oh, well, you know how boys are. Always running around a lot. Of course, Fred's old enough to know what he's doing, but I always thought if Fred and Edna hadn't split up, things might have been different. Edna's a fine girl.
Yes, I know.
Oh, did you know Edna?
Well, that is, I've heard about her.
Yes. Well, she was a good wife to Fred, but he just couldn't seem to settle down. Then he got to drinking and running around with Frank Ellers and another fella I didn't like. But I haven't heard him mention Frank since he's been home this time. Maybe they sort of split up. I do hope so.
Oh, yes, that'd be a good thing for Fred if he'd stay away from fellows like that.
Well, I've got a lot of work to do before I get off. I want you to run out to the house and see us, though, real soon.
Well, I'll do that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, by the way, what's that address again?
It's 226 Oxford Street, apartment 8.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
I better write that down this time.
Well, we'd like to have you come out tonight if you're not busy.
Well, perhaps I will. I have an appointment later this afternoon, but I'll get out there before it's too late.
Well, we'll be expecting you. I know Fred will be glad to see you.
Welch, you boys follow us.
Well, it took you long enough. Did you see her?
Sure. Got the address from her. Fred's been staying at her apartment for the past 3 days.
Think she suspects anything?
Not a chance. She wouldn't have given me the address if she had. She thinks I'm a friend of Charlie's. Gosh, I hated the light of that old lady.
Well, Hamilton didn't hesitate to blow the top of Burke's head off.
Yeah, I know. It's funny about mothers, how they love rats like that.
That's what makes mothers so valuable. Well, here comes Welch and his partner.
I thought he worked with Armstrong.
It's Armstrong's day off. Henry Williams is taking his place today.
Which place is it, Will?
226, right on the corner there. Apartment 8.
Well, that ought to be on the ground floor.
It is. Come on, let's get in there.
Well, I hope Hamilton doesn't see us and decide to give us what Burke got.
You've got something worth thinking about there, son. You better be ready for him.
We'll take care of our end of it.
Hold it. Now, apartment 8 is right here on the corner. Look, Welch,
yeah.
You and Williams plant yourselves under those windows outside, just in case.
Okay.
Paul and I'll take the door here.
Right.
Okay, kid.
Let's go, Paul.
Hey, wait a minute.
Yeah?
You park on that little landing there out of the way and be ready to let him have it if it gets tough. There's no use in both of us get blasted.
He won't get tough.
You can't tell. I'll knock, and if anybody else is in there, I can pretend I'm the Fuller brush man. There's nobody at home here. I hope, I hope, I hope.
Try him again.
I'm wearing out my knuckles on this door.
Well, try the bell.
I did. Not working, as usual, in these places.
Well, knock again.
Hold it. I hear somebody inside.
Sound like a man?
Can't tell you.
Well, what do you want?
Reach for the ceiling, Hamilton.
Well, what is this?
An arrest might be one name for it.
You know what it is, Hamilton.
Who are you, Muggs?
Sheriff's deputies.
Okay, Welch. You and Williams can come in. We got him.
Hey, now look, fellas. You've got me all wrong. I haven't done anything.
Maybe not. Come on, you can stop scratching the plaster off the ceiling now.
That's the gangliest bird I ever saw.
Get those trousers off, Hamilton.
What for?
Never mind, just do as you're told.
Now what?
Well, where'd you get that bullet wound?
Oh, that ain't no bullet wound. It's just...
Yeah, we know. You don't have to tell us. It's where John Burke shot you just before you killed him.
How about it, Hamilton?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Now, look, what makes you think we'd come in here like this with a lot of questions if we hadn't pretty definitely settled that you're the man we're after?
Okay. I guess you got me. What do you want to know?
That's better. Put your pants back on.
All right.
What doctor treated you?
Nobody. I did it myself.
What about your mother and sister? Are they in on this?
They don't know nothing about it. I told them I was sick. Said I had flu.
How'd you happen to pick on old man Burke for a holdup?
Well, about 4 days before the caper, Frank, he's the guy that got bumped off, he introduced me to a guy named Roberts, Al Roberts. Al said he knew a place where we could get our hands on a lot of cash easy. They wanted me to go on a job with him, and I did.
Why?
Oh, I don't know. I was broke, out of a job, didn't have anything particular to do, so I went along. Al stole a car and picked Frank and me up downtown and drove us out to this place on Slauson. Said the old guy that ran the place would be coming out of the little cafe next door pretty soon, and sure enough, he did.
What did you do then?
Well, Al said Frank and me should follow him in and hold him up, and we did.
Why did you kill him?
We gagged him so he couldn't yell, but we didn't tie up his hands. He started shooting, and one shot hit me, so I shot back at him, but it didn't kill him. Then he shot Frank, so I just let him have it.
Where'd you go then?
Well, Al and me went to a place over on San Julian and...
What's wrong with your saps, Jeff, to shoot up the whole neighborhood?
That's your trap. You told us this guy was a cinch.
Yeah, he would have been if you birds hadn't been so white, livid, and you were shaking all over. Why don't you learn to handle a rat?
Oh, save it. Get working on them bullet holes.
You would have to get plugged on this job.
Oh, go easy, you thick-fingered dumbbell.
Don't be so yellow. I ain't hurting you. Look at the slug went clean through.
Yeah, I'd have been a lot luckier if I'd have stayed out of that dump in the first place.
Say, where's that pillow slip?
What pillow slip?
The one Frank had in his pocket to put the jack in.
What? Still in his pocket, I guess. Why, what difference does it make?
All the dim-witted saps. That pillow slip's got the name of yours and Frank's apartment on it.
You're right. They'll trace it. Hey, where you going?
I'm scrambling out of here. I ain't gonna take no rap for you birds. I'm looking out for little Al. So long, sucker.
Al, come back here. Al! Al, you gotta help me. Al, come back here. You gotta help me. You gotta help me. Lousy rat ran out on me and left me laying there. Someday I'll get my hands on that guy, and when I do, his own mother won't know.
Oh, hello, Mr. Killian.
What?
I see.
How do you do, Mrs. Hamilton?
I see you found Freddy at home.
Yes.
My, looks like you've all gotten acquainted.
Oh, yes, we have, Mrs. Hamilton.
Oh, but you're not leaving, are you?
Well,
now, look, Mother, I'm going to run downtown with Killian and the boys for a little while. You won't mind, will you?
Oh, of course not, son. Haven't I always told you to be more careful who you go out with?
Yes, Mother.
You won't let Fred drink too much tonight, will you, Mr. Killian?
No, I don't think he'll drink too much tonight.
Sometimes, friends, it is a crime not to do the things we should. So don't neglect your car. Remember Rio Grande Cracked, the police car performance gasoline that is first in public service, and Real Lube, the newest and finest motor oil sold in the West, at your Rio Grande dealers tomorrow.
Information furnished by Hamilton. His companion was captured in Seattle and returned to Los Angeles, where he was tried with Hamilton on a charge of murder. Both men were convicted and sentenced to life imprisonment in San Quentin Prison. Another example of a crime that did not pay.
Los Angeles County Sheriff's Office calling all cars. Attention all cars. A cancellation of broadcast 251 regarding a holdup. Suspects in this case are now in custody. That's all. Rosenquist.
This is your narrator, Barry Kroger, bidding you good night for Rio Grande.
Down there. It's down close to La Paz. And what I wanted to ask you is this. Will it be all right if we take this officer along with us?
Sure. I've got a young fellow here who would be tickled to death to go. His name is Filkus. Joe Filkus.
Filkus? That's fine. I got a radio set by that name. You see, we'll only be gone a couple of weeks, but I don't want to take a chance on anything happening.
A week later, the producer and his small company are preparing for work in sweltering heat in Lower California.
Now, look here. You better go easy on them drinks, Dennis. This ain't Hollywood. You're in the tropics now, and whiskey in the tropics don't mix, you know.
Oh, don't worry about me, J.K. I never missed a picture cue in my life yet. That's Colby here. Isn't that right, Donald, pal?
He's right, Mr. Fish. He's never missed. Yet.
Sure, but we got an important story conference tonight at my hotel. Carol Gifford's demanding a change in the script.
Oh, what's the matter with that girl? Going temperamental again down here, huh? Look, J.K., I'm the star of the South Sea picture we're making, see? Not Carol Gifford. It's that dizzy blonde
dame. Sure, Dennis, you're the star. But, you see, it's too late to make a change in the cast now. We start shooting first thing in the morning, you know.
Oh, all right. I'll be at your story conference tonight. We'll start shooting in the morning. Only go on away now and let a couple of pals drink in peace.
Okay, but you better show up tonight. The La Paz Hotel, room for...
Those prints in the sand. I'm going to stand on your body and lace your rubber sneakers back on your feet. Get it, Clark? The perfect murder.
I want a drink. I want a drink. I don't want a whistle. Come on, let me have it. Let's go get a little...
It's right here, a belly full of ocean.
Jay, what? It's cold. Don, what's that?
Quit leaving me, you fool. It's too late now. Get your head back under that water. I've got to do it, Dennis. It's the only way Fish will ever give me the lead in that picture. Yeah, quit your wriggling.
For God's sake, stop it. You're drowning me.
You've got to die. This time your head goes under the stay. A couple of more minutes and it'll be over. 1 second. Two, three, four, five, six, seven.
2 hours later, just before dawn, Mr. Fish is aroused by violent pounding on his door.
Mr. Fish, wake up! Wake up, Mr. Fish!
Who is it?
It's me, Colby. Open the door, Mr. Fish. It's important. Please hurry.
All right. Wait till I get my bathrobe on. What is this, Colby? It's a fine time to...
Hey, what's the matter? You look like you've seen a ghost.
It's Dennis Clark, Mr. Fish. He's dead.
What?
Yeah, dead. Drowned. I saw him stretched out on the beach. I tried to revive him, but I couldn't.
But are you sure he's dead? Did you call a doctor?
No, I came here for...
What was Mr. Courtney going to do for the lot owners?
Well, he convinced some of the owners that they'd made bad investments when they bought lots. He told them that he had a lot of money invested in the tract and that he was representing the minority lot owners, and he could help them get their money back.
For a consideration, no doubt.
Naturally. His minimum fee was 10% of the original investment.
My gosh, that's high.
Nothing cheap about Dapper Don. Of course, when the Saps found out that their investment was perfectly safe and with a legitimate company, it was too late. Dapper Don had their 10% and they had nothing.
What was the big idea behind all this?
There's somebody back of him with money who wanted that tract to land. And they figured the simplest way to get it was to run the owning company into bankruptcy.
Oh. Well, that's been done before.
Yes, and it's being done again on a building and loan out in Hollywood.
Well, why doesn't somebody tell the grand jury about these things?
My friend, your lack of sophistication amazes me. Not only has the grand jury been told, but so has the corporation commission. And Dapper Don goes merrily along, still whispering.
Yeah, so you want me to go out and pick him up on a narcotics charge, huh?
I don't care what you pick him up on, so long as I get the first interview with him.
Okay, Tom Swift, get your wireless machine. Let's go.
That's Courtney's office right over there, across the air shaft. The one with the Venetian blinds in it.
Doesn't look like a very big layout.
That one and the one adjoining it.
We're going to have to put dictaphones in both of them.
What's the matter with tapping the telephone?
It's illegal.
So?
I'm going to carry you through the shallow water here, all the way back to a spot on the beach just in front of the shack.
Piggyback. All right, Don, old pal. Let's go piggybacking. Piggybacking, my old pal.
Don't shake so much. I don't want you falling off and getting your feet and your clothes wet. Here we are. Just the spot. Straight in line with the shack's beach door. Wait. Don't get off. I want your feet dry, not wet.
What about that drink, Don, old pal? I need a drink.
In a few minutes now, Clark. It's too bad you're too drunk to appreciate the details. Else you'd learn what a perfect crime this is going to be.
Don't know how drunk I am.
You won't be singing along, you fool. Not with your head deep in the water and your legs stretched out on the sand. Well, here you go. Feet first. That's perfect. Stretched out like a perfect stiff.
Say, who hit me?
Nobody hit you, Clarky, old pal. Just lie there quietly. You're going to help me to eliminate you. Help me to take your place as the star of the picture you're doing tomorrow. You want to help me, don't you?
Sure, you want a drink. Anything, Donald Boy, old boy.
You fool, I'm going to kill you. And after you're stretched out here dead with your head in the water, I'm going back to the shack the same way I came. And I'm going to put on your shoes, your rubber sneakers, and then stagger like a drunk over the sand from the house to here. The last foot...
He told us that he saw a tall man run out of Burke's office here and that the man limped badly.
Tall man, huh?
Yeah, this fellow said the guy must have been 6 feet or more.
Did he have a gun, or did this fellow notice?
Yeah, had a gun in his hand. He piled into a car that was parked in front with another fellow at the wheel, and the car turned down the alley next door and beat it.
You know, there's a bare possibility that this fellow here was a customer of Burke's.
Sort of innocent bystander, huh?
About that?
No, not very likely. They found this roll of wire in his coat pocket and these rubber gloves and this heavy knife.
Well, it looks like they were about to tie Burke up.
That's the way it looks to us.
Now, here's a pillow slip that we found in the other pocket of his overcoat. The name of the apartment it came from is stitched into the hem there.
Hmm. Bavaria Apartments, 843 South Maple. Well, that ought to be a cinch to trace.
Yeah.
Well, we'll send this fellow in for a postmortem. Maybe his fingerprints will identify him.
That's a good idea. We'll get Frank Gompert to run a ballistics test on these bullets and find out which one killed him. Meantime, I think we better take a look at the Bavaria Apartments.
Checking with the manager of the apartment house regarding the slain bandit, Killian and Mahoney received the information.
No, no one like that lives here. Don't know who stole Philo Slip.
At the morgue, the dead man's fingerprints were taken and compared with files in the police department as well as in the sheriff's office. It was learned...
These prints belonged to Frank Eller, convicted of theft, California Motor Vehicle Code, drunkenness, petty theft, address unknown.
Armed with this information, Killian and Mahoney returned to the apartment house...
Police calling all cars, attention all cars, and cancellation of broadcast 250. Suspect in this case is now in custody. That's all. Rosenquist.
This is your narrator, Frederick Lindsley, bidding you good night. For Rio Grande. Calling All Cars, a copyrighted program created by Rio Grande.
Los Angeles Police calling all cars, attention all cars, broadcast 250 at the Dollar Line docks in Wilmington. See the officer. That's all. Rosenquist.
This evening, Rio Grande presents Murder on the Left, with the Welch to blame for most of the crime. When the varmints had to make the getaway on horseback, they couldn't get so far.
Whether he is right or wrong, friends, this much is true. Law enforcement officers in California use good automobiles and the best gasoline money can buy. More fire engines, ambulances, and police cars are powered with Rio Grande cracked wherever it is sold than any other brand. California state and federal government officials also use Rio Grande crack to power their emergency public serving equipment. Benefit by the split-second starting, swift acceleration, the top power and speed, and amazing mileage of this better gasoline. So, friends, if you're getting anything less, if you want real police car performance in your car, set your compass for the nearest red and white Rio Grande station and get it with Rio Grande cracked, the most highly recommended public serving gasoline in the West.
Salient facts regarding our program tonight have been taken from records on file in the Los Angeles Police Department. We have therefore asked Chief of Police James E. Davis to open our program. Chief Davis.
It is the duty of every police department to furnish to its citizens as much protection as it can. Sometimes the work of a local peace officer will carry him far beyond the limits of his local jurisdiction. In such instances, it is necessary that he cooperate with local officials in whatever political division.
You see, here's a bullet hole in Burke's right cheek.
Yeah, evidently shot twice, though, because it's obvious that the shot in the top of the head is the one that killed him.
That's right. That's why I figure he fired over his shoulder. The man he killed must have been to his left, and there must have been another fellow on the right.
Well, there aren't any guns except this one that belonged to Burke. We found these three bullets. One, evidently, is the one that killed this hold-up man. This one we dug out of the wall over there.
Must be the one that killed Burke.
That's the way we figured it.
Where'd the third one come from?
We found it over there by that steel door.
Hmm. Looks like it's got blood on it.
And Burke must have hit the other bandit, too.
Well, that's what we think. That bird there has only one bullet wound in him, and since this bullet's bloody, stands to reason that the other man is hit, too.
Are we sure there was another man?
Yeah, pretty sure. The The fellow who was just going into the cafe next door when all the shooting started told us that he saw a tall man run out of Burke's office here and that the man limped badly.
Tall man, huh?
Yeah, this fellow said the guy must have been 6 feet or more.
Did he have a gun, or did this fellow notice?
Yeah, had a gun in his hand. He piled into a car that was parked in front with another fellow at the wheel, and the car turned down the alley next door and beat it.
You know, there's a bare possibility that this fellow here was a customer of Burke's.
Sort of innocent bystander, huh?
About that?
No, not very likely. They found this roll of wire in his coat pocket and these rubber gloves and this heavy knife.
Well, it looks like they were about to tie Burke up.
That's the way it looks to us.
Now, here's a pillow slip that we found in the other pocket of his overcoat. The name of the apartment it came from is stitched into the head.
Okay, Chief.
Ride that train into Los Angeles and bring him in.
You're wasting your time, copper. You can't make this rap stick.
Maybe you're right, but I'll take a chance on it.
Although Powell searched every part of the train where he thought Ed Courtney might be hiding, the fugitive was not to be found for the simple reason that he had bribed a train employee to hide him in an upper berth. Don was led off and booked, but next day was out on bail, breathing threats against the police. Then, mysteriously, 4 days later, Brother Don surrendered Ed. Then started a story of the law's delays. Ed and his companion, who had been arrested carrying the marked money which the newspaper reporter had given Powell for the purchase of narcotics, had been released with ridiculously light sentences. Dapper Don managed to delay his trial time after time. And while he delayed, he was busy fixing things. Having already married one potential witness, he now managed to have the girl Dorothy disappear. And while a charge of tampering with witnesses was being considered, any hope of obtaining a conviction on a morals charge was shattered when the case was quietly dismissed. Insufficient evidence hampered the pressing of bunco charges. Courtney complained bitterly that newspapers and the publicity given his case had wrecked him financially. Then he sank to a lower form of crime, extortion.
Good morning, sister. Tell your boss I want to see him.
I'm very sorry, but Mr. Sullivan is quite busy right now. Would you care to wait?
Just take this envelope into him. I think he'll see me.
Yes, sir.
And never mind opening it.
Come. Smith, you keep your eye on the train and see if his brother gets off on that side. If he does, Uptight and Luckenbeck will get him. Robinson, you watch the back platform. Harry, come with me and we'll pick up Don.
Are you still going to try to pin a narcotic rap on him?
Yeah, we can't seem to get anybody interested in getting him on anything else.
The Corporation Commission didn't do anything about his whispering campaign?
No. There's something fishy about that bird, but I can't find out what it is. He knows too many people.
Yeah, maybe he's got a good lawyer.
Well, that wouldn't get him out of all his jams.
Wait a minute. I see him. He's fixing to get off.
Okay, let's keep this quiet now.
Where's Carter?
He's over there all set with the photographer. All right, Mr. Courtney. Take it easy now.
What?
We're police officers and you're under arrest.
Oh, yeah? Well, what's the charge?
Suspicion of narcotic violation.
What? Don't make me laugh.
We'll try not to. Take a look in those bags, Harry.
I'll get you for this, Chitwood.
Yeah, I thought it was about time you said that. How about it, Harry?
Pretty good, Eddie. 2.45 automatics and enough dope to send him to jail for the rest of his life.
Now, look, you're making a mistake, coppers. Those are not my bags.
No? Whose are they?
They belong to my brother.
What?
Hey, Harry, there's Courtney's brother in the vestibule. Grab him.
Okay, Chief.
Ride that train into Los Angeles and bring him in.
You're wasting your time, copper. You can't make this rap stick.
Maybe you're right, but I'll take a chance on it.
Although Powell searched every part of the train where he thought Ed Courtney might be hiding, the fugitive was not to be found for the simple reason that he had bribed a train employee to hide him in...
Friends, the Calling All Cars programs are not fairy tales, but the careful presentation of dramatic facts. We observe the same principle in telling the story of Rio Grande cracked gasoline. When you were told that Rio Grande cracked is the motor fuel of police car performance, it is supported by facts which no one can deny. Here are some of them.
Rio Grande cracked powers more police cars, fire engines, ambulances, and other emergency equipment wherever it is sold than any other brand.
And that's not all.
In addition to a vast majority of your city and county officials, many heads of your California state and federal governments also prefer Rio Grande cracked to power their emergency automotive equipment.
And the reason for this overwhelming endorsement by those who drive the most and thus know the most about gasoline is that Rio Grande cracked has proved to be quicker starting, smoother in acceleration, with greater power and maximum speed, giving the kind of mileage that saves the money of taxpayers like you and me. And so, if you're more interested in gasoline facts than in gasoline fairy stories, drop around at the red and white Rio Grande station in your neighborhood and get the most highly recommended gasoline in the West.
The story we failure to hear tonight is to be found in the confidential files of the Office of the Sheriff of Los Angeles County. We have therefore asked Sheriff Eugene Biscaloos to open our program.
Charlie.
Oh, of course. Well, how is Charlie?
Why, he's swell.
Oh.
He wanted me to look you up when I got out here and say hello and all that sort of thing.
I get off at 3. It's almost that time now. Why don't you wait and go out to the house with me? I'd like to have you meet my other boy, Fred, and Lydia.
Oh, is Fred living with you now?
Why, yes. He's been staying with us 2 or 3 days now.
Well.
Of course, it's a small place, and we're sort of crowded. But Fred hasn't been feeling well, and I wanted to have him where I could keep an eye on him.
Yes, some boys are a trial to mothers.
Oh, Fred's a good boy. Never been in any trouble at all. Oh, he drinks a little now and then, but nothing serious.
Well, no, I wouldn't think he would, having a mother like you.
Oh, well, I've tried to do the best I knew how about it, children. Oh, Charlie's a fine boy, don't you think?
Oh, yes, Charlie's a swell guy.
And I want you to meet Lydia, too. She's a fine girl. Oh, she's going to be married soon, though.
Is that so?
Uh-huh, and I just don't know what I'll do. Lydia and Fred have always been my babies, sort of. And when she leaves, well, I'll just kind of be lost, I reckon.
Well, but there's still Fred.
Oh, well, you know how boys are. Always running around a lot. Of course, Fred's old enough to know what he's doing, but I always thought if Fred...
We sure there was another man.
Yeah, pretty sure. The fellow who was just going into the cafe next door when all the shooting started told us that he saw a tall man run out of Burke's office here and that the man limped badly.
Tall man, huh?
Yeah, this fellow said the guy must have been 6 feet or more.
Did he have a gun, or did this fellow notice?
Yeah, had a gun in his hand. He piled into a car that was parked in front with another fellow at the wheel, and the car turned down the alley next door and beat it.
You know, there's a bare possibility that this fellow here was a customer of Burke's.
Sort of innocent bystander, huh?
About that?
No, not very likely. They found this roll of wire in his coat pocket and these rubber gloves and this heavy knife.
Well, it looks like they were about to tie Burke up.
That's the way it looks to us.
Now, here's a pillow slip that we found in the other pocket of his overcoat. The name of the apartment it came from is stitched into the hem there.
Hmm. Bavaria Apartments, 843 South Maple. Well, that ought to be a cinch to trace.
Yeah.
Well, we'll send this fellow in for a postmortem. Maybe his fingerprints will identify him.
That's a good idea. We'll get Frank Gompert to run a ballistics test on these bullets and find out which one killed him. Meantime, I think we better take a look at the Bavaria Apartments.
Checking with the manager of the apartment house regarding the slain bandit, Killian and Mahoney received the information.
No one like that lives here. Don't know who stole little slip.
At the morgue, the dead man's fingerprints were taken and compared with files in the police department as well as in the sheriff's office. It was learned...
These prints belong to Frank Eller, convicted of theft. California motive.
This is Deputy Mahoney, my partner.
How do you do?
How are you, ma'am?
I'm the person you're looking for.
Oh.
However, I'm not Mrs. Hamilton. Fred and I have been divorced for some time. That's why I took back my own name.
Are you married now?
Yes, I've been married several months.
Well, then you don't know where Hamilton is now, huh?
No, I don't. May I ask why you're looking for him?
We're pretty certain he killed a man.
Oh.
And you don't know where he is?
No. If I did, I'd tell you. If he's guilty, I hope you catch him, but I haven't seen him in months. Say, why don't you check with his mother and sister? They live here. I don't know where they do live, but his sister works downtown. I can give you the name of the firm, and you can contact her.
Yeah, we'd appreciate it if you would.
You don't have any pictures of Hamilton lying around, do you?
No, but I have some negatives of old snapshots. You can have those if you want them.
Say, we do.
Say, incidentally, Fred has two brothers in Texas. One's living at Alney, and the other lives at Abilene.
Oh, you know their names?
Well, I think Ed lives at Alney, and Charlie lives in Abilene.
Ed and Charlie. Well, we'll have the Texas officers keep a watch on the brothers' homes. Maybe Fred will show up there.
Yeah. Oh, I almost forgot the negatives. Here they are.
Thank you. We'll take care of them and get them back to you.
Oh, you can keep them for all I care. Or throw them away. I don't care if I never see or hear from that man again.
Dispatching telegrams to the police in the towns where Hamilton's brothers lived, Killian and Mahoney continued their investigation in Los Angeles.
Friends, the Calling All Cars programs are not fairy tales, but the careful presentation of dramatic facts. We observe the same principle in telling the story of Rio Grande cracked gasoline. When you were told that Rio Grande Cracked is the motor fuel of police car performance, it is supported by facts which no one can deny. Here are some of them.
Rio Grande Cracked powers more police cars, fire engines, ambulances, and other emergency equipment wherever it is sold than any other brand.
And that's not all.
In addition to a vast majority of your city and county officials, many heads of your California state and federal governments also prefer Rio Grande Cracked to power their emergency automotive equipment.
And the reason for this overwhelming endorsement by those who drive the most, and thus know the most about gasoline, is that Rio Grande Cracked has proved to be quicker starting, smoother in acceleration, with greater power and maximum speed, giving the kind of mileage that saves the money of taxpayers like you and me. And so, if you're more interested in gasoline facts than in gasoline fairy stories, drop around at the red and white Rio Grande station in your neighborhood and get the most highly recommended gasoline in the West.
The story we are to hear tonight is to be found in the confidential files of the office of the Sheriff of Los Angeles County. We have therefore asked...
Gold in the West. You'll find them both at your independent Rio Grande dealers tomorrow.
And now, Chief Davis.
Colby was arrested and turned over to the Mexican authorities. He was tried and given the sentence prescribed by law. Because of his American citizenship, however, his sentence was somewhat lightened. But so far as we know, he has never returned to the United States, nor did he ever reap any profit from his crime.
Thank you, Chief Davis.
Los Angeles police calling all cars, attention all cars, a cancellation broadcast 250. Suspects in this case delivered to Mexican authorities for punishment. That's all. Rosenquist.
Grandy has presented Murder on the Left, with Grant Withers featured as Don Colby.
You Don, old pal?
Yeah, it's your old pal Don, just back from the story conference at the hotel. And you're going to help me be a star, see?
Don, old pal, old pal.
Yeah, me. Me and you are going to do things tonight.
How about a drink?
Later. First, I've got to set this clock back an hour and a half. Back to 10:45. And then I'll tip this table over. Whiskey bottles, glasses, clock and all. And the clock will stop at 10:45. Get it? It'll look like you did it in a drunken stagger.
What are you celebrating, Donald, pal? Let me in. Let's have a drink. Give me a drink.
Next, I'll tear down these door drapes, and that'll look as if you tore them on your way out to the beach. There. The left drape. I mustn't forget you're left-handed, eh, Clark?
How about a little drink? Let's have a drink. I want to celebrate, too.
You'll get your drink, Clark. Here, lift up your foot.
Hey, what are you taking my shoes off for?
Oh, we're going for a little walk, Clark. It's nice and cool outside, and you won't need these rubber sneakers.
Oh, yeah, great guy, Don. You're a swell pal, a real pal.
I got your sneakers off. We'll leave them here. I'll take off mine, too. Okay, let's go. Here, keep off the grass. Don't step on the sand. That's it. Along this lawn.
They had to get an injunction from Judge Dorn to keep him quiet.
How come?
Well, it seems our dapper friend was carrying on a whispering campaign.
Is that so? What was he whispering about?
Well, it turns out that the Cincinnati people were developing a new tract. Our friend Courtney wanted to get his hands on it, so he formed a Cincinnati Realty Corporation Lot Owners Recovery Commission.
Sounds important.
It was important to the Cincinnati people.
Just what was Mr. Courtney going to do for the lot owners?
Well, he convinced some of the owners that they'd made bad investments when they bought lots. He told them that he had a lot of money invested in the tract and that he was representing the minority lot owners, and he could help them get their money back.
For a consideration, no doubt.
Naturally. His minimum fee was 10% of the original investment.
My gosh, that's high.
Nothing cheap about Dapper Don. Of course, when the saps found out that their investment was perfectly safe and with a legitimate company, it was too late. Dapper Don had their 10% and they had nothing.
What was the big idea behind all this?
There's somebody back of him with money who wanted that tract to land. And they figured the simplest way to get it was to run the owning company into bankruptcy.
Oh. Well, that's been done before.
Yes, and it's being done again on a building and loan out in Hollywood.
Well, why doesn't somebody tell the grand jury about these things?
My friend, your lack of sophistication amazes me. Not only has the grand jury been told, but so has the corporation commission. And Dapper Don goes merrily along, still whispering.
Yeah, so you want me to go out and pick him up on a narcotics charge, huh?
I don't care what you pick him up on, so long as I get the first interview with him.
Okay, Tom Swift, get your wireless...
Back here, priest.
How long has this man lived here?
Oh, not long. Week, 10 days, maybe.
What's his name?
Hamilton, his name, he tell me.
What's his first name?
Oh, Fred, I think it is.
Fred Hamilton, huh?
Here's the apartment, please. It's not locked.
Empty.
Yeah, but it speaks volumes, Paul.
I'll say. Take a look at the blood on that bed.
Oh, so here's one of my good towels, all soaked with blood.
Here's a real find, Will.
Yeah?
Here's a pair of pants I found in the trash basket. Take a look at the length of these.
I go back to office, please.
Well, unless I miss my guess, that's blood on those pants, too.
Sure it is. And here's a bullet hole right below the waistband, front and back.
Huh. Bullet went right through him.
Looks that way.
Judging from the length of these pants, I'd say this bird's 6.5 feet tall at least.
I'd just as soon have these as a picture of the guy.
Uh-oh, here's something.
What'd you find?
Iodine swabs and old bandages.
Well, looks like Hamilton's the man we're looking for.
Yeah, but where to look, that's another question.
Well, oh, here's another pair of pants.
Yeah?
Maybe these will turn up something. Yep. Take a look at this.
What is it?
Property tag from the General Hospital, dated December 25th, 1937. Oh, that's just about a month ago.
Patient number 83564, Ward 5200. Name Frank Ellers. See, that is something.
Hey, wait a minute, there's something written on the back.
Yeah, see.
It's me, honey. J.K.
What do you want? I'm sleepy.
It's very important, Carol. Please, open the door.
Oh, all right. Hold your horses. I'll be there in a minute. Well, what's so darn important about waking a girl up at 2:30 in the morning?
It's about Dennis Clark. He's dead.
What? Say that again.
I think he's been murdered.
Who?
Dennis Clark. Dennis Clark.
Dennis Clark? Well, are you sure? Who told you? Well, have you seen him? Oh, here, come in.
Who told you? Are you sure? Yeah, yeah. He's dead. Drowned like a rat.
Drowned? Say, are you drunk? Clark murdered, then he's drowned. Was this your idea of a joke?
No, it's no joke, honey. Get your clothes on. The police want to question all of us, you included.
Police? Then you are serious.
I'll say I am. Plenty serious, and you better not...
Me? Say, you're not getting me into any mess, Clark. Clark murdered, and you want me, your own girlfriend, to stick a pretty neck right into it. Say, what have I got to do with it?
You don't understand, honey. I'm trying to keep you out of any scandal or excitement. That's why I'm here, before the police get to you.
Fish and Miss Gifford returned to the cottage where Lieutenant Filkus had begun an investigation.
Right here, honey.
Well, I guess everybody's here now.
Public service. And now, Chief Davis.
In spite of Dapper Don's attempts to again clog the wheels of justice, he was nevertheless brought to trial on March 26, 1937. And because of two prior convictions, his sentence resulted in his being sent to Folsom Penitentiary for a period of 10 years. And an additional sentence of 1 year to life. His was another crime that did not pay.
Thank you, Chief Davis.
Los Angeles Police calling all cars, attention all cars, and cancellation of broadcast 250. Suspects in this case are now in custody. That's all. Rosenblatt.
Narrator Frederick Lindsley, bidding you good night for Rio Grande.
Calling All Cars, a copyrighted program created by Rio Grande.
That's Courtney's office right over there, across the air shaft, the one with the Venetian blinds in it.
Doesn't look like a very big layout.
That one and the one adjoining it.
We're going to have to put dictaphones in both of them.
What's the matter with tapping the telephone?
It's illegal.
So what?
So we're not going to do it.
Oh, so you're going to do it the hard way.
That's right.
Getting like Horatio Alger.
Yeah.
Hey, it looks like somebody's sitting on Courtney's desk.
Yeah, that's where the delinquency of the miner comes in.
Hmm. Hey, what time does this guy go home?
Well, about 10 minutes. He's on schedule.
You know all the answers, don't you?
I've been working on this case.
Does the blonde go with him?
Yeah, usually.
Nuts.
You're going to have to be what is known as agile to get over there.
No trick at all. I've done it lots of times.
You're going to get shot climbing in windows someday.
What does that guy do here this late at night?
I'm surprised at you.
He makes telephone calls. What do you think?
Oh, yeah, I know. Two minority stockholders.
Wait a minute. There they go.
If he runs true to form, he'll leave a light on.
Well, that'll help.
He's getting thrifty. He turned it off.
Any chance if he's coming back?
Never has before.
How about night watchman here?
A couple of door rattlers will make the rounds about once an hour.
All right, let's get over there. Powell, you go get the car and bring it around the back door, and one of us will let you in.
Okay, Eddie.
Okay, newshound, let's go.
Better watch those telephone wires. I tripped over them the last time I came across here.
Hey, you're a regular housebreaker, aren't you?
No, just a private investigator.
About? I ain't saying nothing.
Slightly ungrammatical, but clear. All right, Courtney, give me that money you got for the narcotic you just delivered.
I ain't got it. No, but Bob has. Come on, shell out.
Give it to them, Bob.
Is that all of it, Carter?
Let me count it. Yeah, that's all of it. $250.
Is that the same money you gave Harry?
It's the money, all right. These are the babies we're after.
Where do you get your supply, Courtney?
I don't know what you're talking about.
I'll bet you don't.
How about your brother? Is he handling the stuff?
I don't know anything about it.
How about it, Bob?
I ain't saying nothing.
Yeah, I believe you mentioned that before. Okay, drive on.
Where to?
The city jail, my friend.
But Chitwood and his allies had nothing to connect Dapper Don Courtney with the charge of dope peddling. The brother Ed obtained his release on bail, and the two Courtneys headed for St. Louis to spend the intervening time before Ed's trial. Meantime, police had arranged to trace the leads that had been obtained from their dictaphone. They brought in two girls for questioning.
I might just as well put my cards on the table and tell you two girls what I want. I'm after Don Courtney on a narcotics charge.
I'm afraid you come to the wrong place to get your information, Captain. We don't know anything about Don Courtney.
Why, I scarcely know Don at all.
I happen to know better than that. I've had calls on Courtney's phone traced to the apartment where you two girls live. I've had men watching your place night and day for several weeks. And if you want to tell me the truth, all right.
Oh.
There. Real I got down. Your sneakers off. We'll leave them here. I'll take off mine, too. Okay, let's go. Here, keep off the grass. Don't step on the sand. That's it. Along this lawn. Well, here we are, Dennis. The rocky ledge. There. Watch your step. Easy. Okay. Now get on my back. I'm going to carry you through the shallow water here, all the way back to a spot on the beach just in front of the shack.
Piggyback. All right, Don, old pal. Let's go piggybacking. Piggybacking my old pal.
Don't shake so much. I don't want you falling off and getting your feet and your clothes wet. Here we are. Just the spot. Straight in line with the shack's beach door. Wait. Don't get off. I want your feet dry, not wet.
What about that drink, Don, old pal? I need a drink.
In a few minutes now, Clark. It's too bad you're too drunk to appreciate the details. Else you'd learn what a perfect crime this is going to be.
Don't know how drunk I am.
You won't be singing along, you fool. Not with your head deep in the water and your legs stretched out on the sand. Well, here you go. Feet first. Ah, that's perfect. Stretched out like a perfect stiff.
Say, who hit me?
Nobody hit you, Clarky, old pal. Just like...